and shuddered. He helped lead them to their last World Series title. Then the Sox sold him to the hated Yankees. And in his wake, Babe Ruth left what superstitious New Englanders refer to as the curse. In the 85 years since, masses of talent have worn the uniform of both fabled franchises. But over the span of those great eras, the Red Sox have failed to win another World Series title.
And Cincinnati has won the World Championship, beating the Boston Red Sox.
While the Yankees have cornered the market with 26 trophies.
Yankees win! Yankees win!
There have been moments when the Sox looked like they would finally trump the pinstripers from the Bronx, but the influences of history fade slowly.
Gonna be out of here, a home run for Bucky Dent.
There have been moments when finally their elusive title seemed within their grasp, only to roll away.
Little roller up along first, behind the bag, it gets through Buckner.
Will this be the year for the Sox to shed the ghosts of the past, or will the Yankees and their success continue to haunt Boston for yet another season? The answers begin to unravel next as they meet for the first time this season on Monday Night Baseball.
In baseball, if the Yankees will not relinquish first place, without a fight, they're now a game up on the Red.
Teams as close as they are in proximity, of course you're going to have a rivalry, but I think also bad blood. There's a lot of things that cause certain rivalries, but I think geographically you can have a rivalry.
Don't you need to sort of prevent a season? Everybody knows. And you see the World Series titles, many of those back on.
The Rocket Man arriving in the place he once called home, Boston's Fenway Park, where the Yankees are never quite embraced, but where tonight we embrace the best in the business. It's a rivalry that's unsurpassed. The Babe kindled it. And the fire between the Yankees and Red Sox has burned ever since. Tonight, it's lit again with the return of the Rocket to the mound, where he once made history.
Roger Clemens has broken the Major League record.
Now Clemens, the Yankee, is just too shy of 300 wins from the mound to the booth. Another living legend returns to Fenway.
And there's a long drive to deep right.
Kurt Gowdy joins us for the renewal of a grudge match and a battle for first. The Yankees and Red Sox next on Wednesday Night Baseball.
Here's the payoff pitch. There it goes! It's out of here!
3-2 to bat.
Struck him out!
The 0-1 pitch.
Swings!
A liner!
But a special night this should be here at Fenway Park in Boston, where the New York Yankees and Boston Red Sox renew, if you will, hostilities. And hi once again, everybody. I'm Chris Berman. Welcome to ESPN2's Wednesday Night Baseball. Let's see. Yankees, Red Sox tied for first place. Let's see. Roger Clemens comes back to Boston, sitting on the verge of one of the most impressive milestones in baseball history. Joining me, as he does many times on Wednesday night, is Hall of Famer Joe Morgan. And Joe, for 20 years now, when you say Roger Clemens is pitching, you know exactly what you're going to get. It's excitement.
Roger who? I thought this was Kurt Gowdy.
Well, tonight. We'll get to that.
Yeah. Well, with Roger Clemens, you have the ultimate in baseball. There's the power hitters and the power pitchers. Guys who strike out a lot of hitters and the hitters who hit home runs, they all get your attention. We don't have Barry Bonds with us tonight, but we do have Roger Clemens, and he will strike out some Red Sox tonight.
We do have Barry Bonds with us tonight. We got Barry Bonds, Willie Mays, Ted Williams, Carl Yastrzemski. We've got them all. We've got the best in the business, at least in our business. Joining us to kick off our Living Legend series is one. Kurt Gowdy, for many, many years here in the 50s and 60s, voice of the Red Sox, voice of everything that we saw growing up. Welcome home to Fenway, Kurt, and welcome to us.
Thank you, Chris. Great to be with you and Joe. You know, this is a great rivalry, and I think it really started in 1920 when the Red Sox, Harry Frazee, the owner, a Broadway producer, sold Babe Ruth to the New York Yankees. Ruth was probably the greatest young talent in baseball then, and the fans hated not only Frazee, but the Yankees for buying him. Then he sold a couple of more good Red Sox players to the Yankees. And ever since then, there's been that rivalry. And it's a natural rivalry, 200 miles apart, the Red Sox nation, the Yankee nation. And it's still going and always will go.
And the Babe personified out here 80 years later, and Roger Clemens, once one of us, if you will, for Boston now, one of them.
Yeah,
you
you're
do
right.
us a favor. Can you stick around and call a few innings for us?
Can I?
You're in. I can make that happen. Roger Clemens was a Sox. Now try to beat the Sox tonight.
I mean, considering...
ESPN2's Wednesday Night Baseball, brought to you by Eagle One. Need a new way to wax? Try Eagle One Waxes You Dry. Wash car, spray on, dry off. You're done.
A special night for baseball and a special night, I'm sure, for all of you watching at home or wherever you may be. Kirk Gowdy joins us in the booth at Fenway Park for the Yankees and Red Sox. Two teams, 28-17, and a flat-footed tie for first place here in the AL East. They have split the two games thus far. Their first two meetings of the year. Monday, the Yankees won 7-3. They jumped up after four pitches and got a lead they never surrendered. Last night, a different story. The Yankees had a first-inning lead, but Boston came roaring from behind to win it at 10-7. And here are the lineups tonight for Joe Torre's Yankees, who in the last nine have gone 2-7. So they need to get some of their guys, like Jason Giambi, hitting number three, going. Bernie Williams is playing hurt. His left knee is bothering him a little bit. And, of course, with Nick Johnson, who was off to a very good start out for now, it looks like 6 weeks, Joe Morgan. This lineup, it's very tough at the top, but they need some of their big guns to get going.
Well, unfortunately for the Yankees, their offense sputtered lately. I mean, they got off to a great start. They were hitting home runs 2 and 3 a game, but now they started to struggle a little bit with their offense. And Tim Wakefield's not the right guy to get out of a slump on. A knuckleball pitcher can be very difficult to hit because the ball dances around. In fact, knuckleball pitchers have been known to put hitters into slumps. So it's not something that you look forward to facing a guy like Wakefield. The only thing Wakefield would have a problem with if it starts to rain and then he's not able to dig into that knuckleball. But other than that, it should work perfectly for him.
Kurt, a knuckleball. We'll take a look at the defense for the Red Sox. And Billy Miller has started to really come on at third base. And Shea Hillenbrand, who was an all-star third baseman last year, is at first. Defensively, this lineup, although Veritek is not going tonight, Mirabelli catches the knuckleballer. Defensively, this is probably the best Boston will do. Kurt on a knuckleballer, Tim Wakefield. I'm sure you had the chance to see the Negroes and Hoyt Wilhelm. You never do get used to it, even calling it, do you?
Oh, there's a slight breeze blowing in. A knuckleballer likes to throw against the wind. That makes his ball act a little differently than the most knuckleballs are different anyway. But he's been, I think he's a senior man in the pitching staff, 9 years he's been here. If he's on, he's tough, and the catcher takes a beating.
And speaking of the catcher, it's Doug Mirabelli who has won the dubious honor of being the catcher for Tim Wakefield. He wears what is a fast-pitched softball glove. He was showing it to me before the game. It's not quite the pizza glove that they used to use catching Wilhelm and some of the other ones way back when. But Mirabelli says, you know, I just assume every pitch is going to be a wild pitch, and I go from there. And that's how I try to catch Mr. Wakefield. However, Wakefield, at 4-1, has been, well, one of the rocks on the Red Sox rotation that has them in first place for the fifth straight year, beginning play on May 21st. Alfonso Soriano begins, and we're sitting with the second baseman here. We're looking at this second baseman, and both Joe and Kurt, I'll ask you what an impression he has made right away in Soriano. Huh, Kurt, he's opened your eyes.
I'll say he has. I'm going to ask Joe, and I know he can answer this, who's the greatest hitting second baseman of all time?
Rogers Hornsby.
Right.
Yeah, I can answer that.
300-400 seasons. Imagine that, hitting 400 three times.
No.
And lifetime average of 358, second to Ty Cobb.
Well, I'm not asking if he's going to catch Rogers Hornsby, but I know, Joe, you play the position so well, he'll be getting the Hall of Fame. Soriano, what an impression. And you still feel he's just learning, right, Joe?
Well, he's special. He's got special talents. And as he gets more experience, he's going to get better.
Pops this up. Last night, he hit a homer in the first inning, but against the knuckleballer, that's different. Garcia Perez squeezes it, and this is what he can do. He is the most feared leadoff hitter, certainly since Ricky Henderson. I think it's safe to say that. And this is him hitting the home run last night off the starter Bruce Chen, who went for Pedro Martinez, who may miss a week or two with a little strain of a muscle in the side. So well, Soriano is gone.
Well, both he and Jeter, Soriano and Jeter, are not your typical first and second place hitters. They're very aggressive. Soriano hit the first pitch for a home run last night, and Jeter will hit the first pitch if it's a strike. I mean, they're very aggressive. They're not your normal guys that go up and take pitches so that their teammates will get a chance to see what the pitcher's throwing that particular day.
Jeter is only back a full week. He's 4-for-10 with 3 RBIs in the first 2 games in the series. So that gives you an idea of how much offense we've had. 10 at-bats. I know he hit second in the lineup, but 10 at-bats in the first 2 games. Both teams can do their mashing. And of course, Jeter and Nomar. And he hits it. Well, this is Billy Miller at third. Across to Hillenbrand. And 2 up, 2 down for the knuckleball, Wakefield.
Jason Giambi has been struggling, but, you know, when you're swinging the bat well, you do not want to face a knuckleball pitcher. But when you're not swinging well, this may get you started because you have to wait a little longer, you have to focus a little better, and you have to really concentrate on each and every pitch. And knuckleball pitchers force you to do that. But one thing about knuckleball pitcher, if you can stay close, you always feel you have a chance in the late innings.
You know, I'm sitting here with Kurt, and the shift is on, as they do against Giambi, with nobody on, with 3 guys. And that's reminiscent of a shift that you used to see them use against somebody that played at Fenway, isn't it, Kurt?
Yeah, Ted Williams faced that years and years. I always ask him why he didn't try and go to left field. He says, look, fans don't come to see me hit a one-hop single out in the left. They come to see me hit a home run.
Well, maybe they came to see Giambi hit a home run, sends it back, and gone! Not enough knuckle, then a lot of pop. And that's one way to bust out of a slump that sees you hitting just above 200, hit a home run at Fenway against the Red Sox. And again, in the first inning, the Yankees have a lead over Boston. It's happened all 3 nights.
Well, Giambi's been having trouble with the high fastball. Wakefield doesn't have one. And you look at the concentration right there. That's what you do on a knuckleball pitcher, and that's why I felt like he could get Giambi out of his slump. I mean, and this is just the first inning. He's going to get some more swings, and I guarantee you Giambi's going to be right on him a lot tonight, because that's what you do when you're in a slump. You really concentrate hard, and he's trying to get himself started.
Giambi's 9th home run of the season. And, I don't mean to be mean, and we'll talk about it, but Giambi going into that at bat was hitting 201. His brother Jeremy Giambi plays for the Red Sox. More on that in a moment. 211. I figure, you know, you add up the two and averages together, they're barely more than Ted's 406.
Yeah, they're 400.
That was a little mean.
Well, I just am doing addition.
That was a little mean.
I'm trying to segue. I heard that in the stands last night, Joe. I saw the stands.
Yeah, that was a little tough. Barely more than his 406, right? Okay.
Well, they're the brothers Giambi, who are just the 3rd set of brothers to play opposite each other at the same time for the Red Sox and the Yankees.
How about the DiMaggio, Joe and Dom? And then there was Vince with the Pirates. What's the odds on one family producing 3 major leaguers?
Not as good as that. Wakefield comes back and strikes out Bernie Williams. Yankees play long ball. Wakefield gets strikeout. And enter the Rocket Man to the hill at Fenway. Jason Giambi hit the home run off Tim Wakefield. The Yankees have the lead in the Red Sox. And manager Grady Little coming to bat. They do a little more than just station-to-station baseball. They run, they move the runner over, they take some chances. They got a lot of hard-nosed players. Todd Walker, new second baseman. Kevin Millar, the DH. Billy Miller, the third baseman. Of course, the big boppers, Garcia Pera and Ramirez, hitting 3-4 against a guy that, well, they all know very, very well, although they weren't teammates of this man, Roger Clemens. He had the 298 wins and just 153 losses. 2 more wins, and Roger will be the 21st man in the history of baseball to get to 300, but only the 14th man since the 20th century. 7 of those were names long gone, and this is Roger this year with an ERA of under 3. He's 5-2, and he's 40 years young, going to turn 41 this summer, but yet, Kurt and Joe, there's just no stopping him. And
because every day he's working hard, isn't he?
Well, he's a great competitor, and he's always had an outstanding work ethic.
Damon has shot the Jeter hands. I mean, you look at him, Kurt and Joe, doesn't he remind you of an old-time guy?
I mean, he is an old throwback player, isn't he?
Well, he was a power pitcher, and that's what used to be. And Kurt and I were talking earlier of the Bob Gibson mode, Sandy Koufax, guys who threw the ball hard. They overpowered you. And the one thing with Roger, you have to be careful. A lot of time, the first inning or so, his adrenaline's flowing. He throws a lot of high fastballs. And that's what you have to be careful of. If he can get through the first inning or so, then he seems to relax and get into the Roger Clemens mode. But sometimes he goes out there, he's throwing, overthrowing at the beginning because he's just hyped up. There's another high fastball, but he gets some help there.
And he's certainly hyped up to be at Fenway. Now, as a visitor at Fenway, he has done very well. 3-0 as a visitor in 7 overall starts. He did lose the one playoff game, the much ballyhooed one to Pedro Martinez in 1999, but undefeated in the regular season, Bernie Williams. And you can see him favoring that knee. It had rained here during the afternoon, not hard, but with the soggy turf and the shaky knee, Todd Walker's ball fell for a base hit. And then here's the Yankee defense, guys, where it's been interesting to watch Hideki Matsui play the left field wall. I don't think they have any of those in Japan.
No, I don't think so. He'll find out. You go back to catch the ball and over your head and it ricochets back. It's really tricky. It's like playing billiards out there.
Who played the wall the best in all the history when you were here?
Carl Yastrzemski and Ted Williams. Mm-hmm. Yastrzemski was a marvelous fielder. He started out as a shortstop. He was probably, I think, one of the two or three best left fielders of all time. They say Al Simmons was a great one with the A's. But Yastrzemski led the league in assists every year. He had a strong arm. He was a master at it.
And a Hall of Famer in the true sense of the word.
Williams is pretty good, too. He had those caroms all figured out. And he didn't have a great arm, but he had a pretty good one. They were both excellent.
Omar Garcia-Pera digs in against Roger Clemens. And he slugs this ball to left center field. Back, it goes back, 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 back. Gone! Game on.
Well, Garcia-Pera, that is, extends his hitting streak. I mean, he's been swinging the bat very, very well, and never put him over 300. There's a pitch, and not a bad pitch. It's away, but it's not down where he wanted it, but Garcia-Pera hits it hard and drives it over that left center field wall. That's not the short course. That's not the short way. He took the long way on that one.
So like Jaime Garcia-Pera with home run number 9, except it comes with a man on in Boston with a 2-1 lead. Well, Kurt, they wanted to make sure that we had some excitement. They knew you were in the park. Nobody wanted to disappoint you.
Well, you know, I'll talk about just a minute. He's ready.
Manny Ramirez in against Rogers. So the fans will be again him. I mean, they want to see their one-time hero really scuffle tonight on the mound for the Yankees.
By the way, Kurt, you go ahead and talk. We'll wait.
Yeah, we're all ears.
You won't be here next week.
No. Those seats above the left field wall have been much discussed. They're new here. I can't get used to them.
Okay.
I used to love to see the ball hit the screen over the wall or disappear in the Lansdowne Street, but no more.
No more.
Hey.
But that's interesting. I mean, it has changed the park. I mean, it's made a big difference in the way you view the green monster now.
Well, that screen, which was 23 feet high above the 37-foot wall, is in dry dock. They're not sure what to do with it yet. They might now. Now, there's a whole nother story there. We weren't going to go to that yet, but and who's sitting up on the wall tonight? Bucky Dent.
Oh,
this is a long story.
Oh man, don't mention that name here. I was sitting in the stands in the playoff game with the Yankees when he hit the home run, the little looper, just over the left field wall to give the Yankees the pennant.
Well, Clemens strikes out Manny Ramirez. Here was 78 Mike Torres on the mound. Red Sox with the lead on a Monday afternoon. And And there it goes.
You can see Yastrzemski go down on one knee there. I mean, he was really torn there when that ball left the ballpark.
It's just an odd. It's a newspaper promotion. It had nothing to do with us here tonight or Roger pitcher or whatever, but Bucky Dent sitting on top of the Green Monster. I mean, it's just, all right, let's see. We got the Rocket on the mound. We got Kurt Gowdy in the booth. We got Joe Morgan, and we'll get to that, who had a pretty good moment here in 1975. I'm just along for the ride here, fellas. Battle for first place.
I will keep reminding you of that.
Good point. I have to tell you this, and I don't want to sound too mushy or whatever, Kurt, and I mean this. I mean, when I first heard you start to speak into this, and I heard it through my ears today, I mean, it brought back memories of, you know, years and years ago when I watched you every Saturday and listened to you, you know, do broadcast baseball games. When we sit here and talk, I hear you in a different vein. But when I hear you as a broadcaster, it really, you know, it kind of takes me back a long way and makes me to a happy time, I guess. So it's an honor for me, and I mean that, just to be in the booth with you. But to listen to you here is going to be worth. I'm going to have a lot of fun tonight.
Thank you, Joe.
What did we talk about, Joe? Just close your eyes and listen. Kevin Millar, 1-2 to him. And action-packed first inning. Solo homer, Giambi, two-run homer, Garcia Pera. Dent, anyway, being up there in the seats, back to that, I mean, it's, you know what he's known as here in Boston. Well, you know, Kurt, Bucky Bleeping Dent.
Yeah.
That was a nickname I didn't give, Joe.
A lot of broken hearts that day in September.
Well, of course, the skipper of the Red Sox is Joe Torre's bench coach, one of our favorite people in the game, Don Zimmer. So, I mean, there's more plots here than an Agatha Christie, you know, more subplots than an Agatha Christie novel. Millar draws a base on balls. So you suggested it, Joe, that Roger might be, and Joe Torre told me that before the game, too.
Fielder,
just a little
seven,
up high in a giddy-up and looks like
Nixon.
Well, I mean, he's not. I mean, look, there are a lot of things going on in his mind when he takes the mound tonight. I mean, he's at 298 wins. He's in Boston. I mean, he's pitching the Yankees, trying to get them back in the first place alone. I mean, there are a lot of things going on when you take the mound in these types of situations, and it takes you sometimes an inning to get to relax. But the one thing I see him doing now, after the first few couple of batters, he's gone to the breaking ball. After Garcia Parra hit the home run, he's gone to throwing a lot of off-speed pitches. That's why he walked Millar. He threw him a couple of splitters that were out of the strike zone. And now he starts Trot Nixon off with a curveball. So he's trying to keep his emotions under control.
Well, Trot Nixon is one of the best batters in the bigs against Roger Clemens. I mean, he has had some big hits. One of the games that you did to Joe, right? The Pedro-Roger matchup at Yankee Stadium on a Sunday night game. 9 for 24, four doubles and two homers against Clemens. It's not a long list of guys that have a record like that. But isn't there always someone, a name that you might not even suspect that for some reason has a great batting? I mean, it comes to mind a man I used to work with. Tommy Hutton would own Tom Seaver for whatever reason. It just happened.
But a lot of times you just see the ball well out of his hands. You can you know, read the pitches quickly. And that's just unusual.
And there goes Millar, and uncontested stolen base. Boston. Kurt, they were never known as the Go-Go Red Sox.
Oh, no. This is a different Boston team. They don't have the power they used to have, but they score runs. And they're consistent through the batting order. They move runners around now, and they score runs, which is very valuable for them.
Well, here's a guy stealing a base for the first time in 4 years, but Nixon strikes out looking. So two K's for Roger, who's third on that list all time. But Giambi's homer was solo. Nomar's homer was duo. 2-1 Boston after one. Back at Fenway Park in Boston. Red Sox 2, Yankees 1. Chris Berman, Joe Morgan, and Kurt Gowdy with us here in the booth. And Hideki Matsui, I don't know how many knuckleballers they have over in Japan, but Joe Torre told me before the game, he just has a hunch. No real facts, but has a hunch that Matsui
is cut out to wait out Wakefield's knuckler. We'll see if his hunch is correct.
Well, remember one thing, in Japan, they throw a lot of off-speed pitches, mm-hmm. curveballs, changeups. So, you know, he's used to seeing, you know, medium-paced pitches.
Kurt, did you ever, in any travels at all, ever see Sanaharu O play? I don't know if you might have gone over there to or not.
No, I never did. He had the big leg kick.
Yeah.
Mel Ott
like. Mel Ott, yeah. He was the big home run king in Japan.
Well, this fella hit 50 last year, but they don't think he's going to be a big home run hitter here. They think he's more of a doubles hitter. They do like the way he plays left field and the way he goes about his business. But he's probably the most polished of those that have come over here, all around skills so far.
Well, I have to argue with them because Ichiro, to me, is by far the superior player of these two.
Well, I didn't mean it's superior just as overall. Well, Ichiro's skills in the outfield and the arm.
I mean, he is. Ichiro, to me, has all the baseball instincts of a Willie Mays and the guys that we grew up watching. I mean, he's aggressive on the bases. He's a great outfielder, very accurate, strong arm. One thing about Matsui, I don't think he's going to hit a lot of home runs here because he doesn't handle a fastball here very mm-hmm. well. And I think that's going to keep him in the ballpark. That's why he hits a lot of balls to left center and back to the middle. He's going to hit because he's a good hitter, but I don't think he's going to hit a lot of home runs. But that's why Joe feels that he might have a chance against a knuckleball pitcher because, you know, he's throwing off-speed pitches rather than the fastball.
You know what? You'd be a good scout for a major league team.
I'm going to send Joe across the ocean.
Scout at large.
Right. Well, you're in. Joe's out. You're in with me.
Okay.
We're bringing you along.
You lied. Joe's too smart.
No, I told you I'm having such a good time. I might talk too much, so calm me down.
Jorge Posada had a long home run last night, but not in this at-bat. Garcia Pera over to Hillenbrand, and there's two outs. You know, just seeing Nomar and Jeter, and I'm not trying to compare them to Ted Williams and Joe DiMaggio, but yet two guys that came up essentially at the same time as those two did. Now, here are the two shortstops, and let's say they both play here 12, 14 years. This is really kind of the continuation of a great head-to-head rivalry, isn't it? Almost like those two.
That is between the two. Also, you have Rodriguez down in Texas. I can't remember shortstops hitting like this. They're great hitting shortstops in the history of the major leagues.
Yeah. And Tejada over in Oakland won the MVP last year, so there are a lot of great hitting shortstops. Well, it's easy to forget because there's so many at the top. I mean, there's so many good shortstops, and you're exactly right.
But these two guys going head-to-head already, they've done it, 96, 97-ish. And they're already kind of the symbols of their respective teams as shortstop, despite the fact that there's so many other big-time players on these squads.
That looked like a good pitch to me.
Uh-oh, he's okay now. He's back to umpire.
I just wished.
Dan Iasonia is the home plate umpire with assist from Kurt Gowdy. Alfonso Marquez at first, Rick Reed second, Tim Cheetah is at third. Robin Ventura, full count to him. Two out, 2-1 game. Home runs by Jambi for the Yankees and two run by Garcia Pera. In the bottom of the first is our scoring thus far. And there's the nutsy. So two Ks for Wakefield, including the third out of both of the first two innings. 2-1 Red Sox. 40 years young Roger Clemens on the hill at Fenway Park, which and swinging at the first pitch is Shea Hillenbrand. And so one up, one down for the Red Sox. Here's what Tim Wakefield's been doing.
A lot of people may not know what a knuckleball does, but watch, once he releases it, you'll see that the stitches, you can see the stitches. That tells you that they're not tumbling. But the stitches, whichever way they tumble, that's the way the ball will end up going. And there's no consistency. Wakefield doesn't know where it's going to end up. The catcher doesn't know. So that's why it's so difficult to hit. The ball is just kind of dancing on the seams as they turn over. And that's why it's so difficult to hit a knuckleball. Plus, the speed is slow.
This is Billy Miller, San Francisco Giant, primarily last year Cub and Giant. And he has really been swinging a hot bat here for the Red Sox. Miller 4-for-7 with a pair of doubles thus far in this series. but gets a slow dribbler there that Soriano gobbles up easily, and there's two outs. You know, let's go to Roger Clemens here, who's on the verge of something, fellas, that we may not. I know Maddux has a chance and Glavin does, but we're not going to see it again. 300 wins. Kurt, I mean, it's 300 wins is about as good as it gets in any sport.
Yeah, absolutely, especially nowadays. But, you know, Clemens was here, I think, 13 years. His last 3 years were rather mediocre. And everybody asked me, why did they ever let him get away? And we'll talk about that in just a minute.
This is Mirabelli, the catcher, hitting ninth. Talk about it whenever you want.
Yeah, Dan Duquette was a general manager. Now, I'm not trying to put any blame on anybody, but he got disenchanted with Clemens and thought that, as he said, he was in the twilight of his career. So they let him walk as a free agent, didn't even trade him for any value. He went to Toronto and had two 20-game seasons, won the Cy Young again.
Mirabelli hits it well. Here comes the throw in, and the number 9 hitter of the Red Sox, Mirabelli, with a double.
So now he goes to the Yankees. He has another Cy Young Award season.
Number 18, Johnny.
He just kept doing it and doing it. He's Red Sox made a big, big mistake in letting him get out of here.
I played with Eddie Matthews, you know, toward the end of his career. And he said to me, he said, Joe, it does everyone good to be traded one time. And what he meant was, you know, you're getting one place, you get accustomed to being there, and you get, maybe you get complacent. But
now you might have.
Yeah, by getting, you know, pushing him out, it rejuvenated Rocket, and he, you know, worked harder maybe, and just
came
back.
Well, I think he got highly motivated when he left here. He got back to his old zeal and, hey, let's go. And he needed, I think, probably there's a break for him to get out of here.
Exactly. No, I mean, it seems like the Red Sox, you know, made a mistake, but if he stayed here, he may not have pitched as well as he has.
Right.
That's why I say, I remember Eddie Matthews said that to me. I was only my second year in the major leagues, but I understood what he meant because he had been traded, and he said that he needed that.
Well, Rogers' last 4 years here was he was 40 and 39.
Yeah.
But then, as you point out, Kurt, two Cy Youngs in Toronto. Four more Cy Young Awards in Toronto than with the Yankees. I mean, people forget that. He only was there 2 years. And then, of course, went to New York. And his first year at the Yankees of 14 and 10. But he really became a Yankee when he won that World Series game against Atlanta. Pitched great, standing ovation. And even he said, it took me all year to really feel like I was a Yankee and I contributed. And then, of course, he had a 21 season Cy Young Award in 2001, went 20-3. And there it is, 192 wins with Boston and 106 elsewhere. When he gets 108, we'll all have a party.
Yep. He will.
Yeah. Good point, Kurt.
You think?
He will. He will.
Popped up by Johnny Damon. Soriano back. Mondesi in. Soriano gets it. And we played two innings, and the Red Sox lead the Yankees 2-1.
How do you think it's going?
Honey, relax. That's why we hired a real estate agent.
But
look, if it's going to make you feel any better, give him a call.
Hello?
Oh, hi. Showing the house right now.
Is your real estate agent working hard enough for you? Century 21 pledge point number one. Century 21 agents are dedicated to selling your home successfully.
I gotta go.
Just one of the ways to help reduce the stress of selling real estate. Century 21, real estate for your world.
One pizza, one pizzone.
What's a pizzone?
The pizzone. It's back at Pizza Hut. Now get any large pizza for your family and get a pizzone of your own for only $2.99.
What's a pizzone?
It's a big taste in a big folded pizza crust filled with cheese and luscious ingredients like pepperoni or fresh veggies. Everything deliciously sealed inside and baked to perfection, plus marinara sauce. Just $2.99 when you buy any large pizza at regular price. No one makes the whole family happy like Pizza Hut.
ESPN2's Wednesday Night Baseball, brought to you by Century 21, the official real estate organization of Major League Baseball.
Sorry, Roger, not here, not tonight. Well, that would sum up what you talked about at the beginning, Kurt. You know, they respect Roger for what he did here, but Hey, he's pitching against the Red Sox. Can't help you tonight.
That's right.
Mondesi, Zeal, and Soriano. Zeal the DH tonight. Mondesi, of course, right field. So that's 8-9-1 against the knuckleballer Tim Wakefield, who is the only guy on this Red Sox team still here that was a teammate of Roger Clemens. They overlapped for 2 years. Roger's last 2 years here, when Wake in 95 and 96. And so that's the last link here on this team to when Roger Clemens was around. Kind of shows you how things have changed. I know it's been a while, but not a ridiculously long time. Tell you what else Wakefield is, and I just find this interesting, is that you wouldn't think a knuckleball pitcher, you know, you talk about Roger Clemens and strikeouts. I'm going to show you this after this pitch, that he's getting up there in some of the Red Sox lists. But look, now, this year, do you believe this, Kurt and Joe? He passed Louis Tiant for the most strikeouts in the history of the Red Sox and moved into fourth place. Only Clemens, Cy Young, and Pedro Martinez have more strikeouts in a Red Sox uniform than Tim Wakefield. That was kind of an eye-opener when I saw that. Mondesi with the walk. How about Louis Tiant when he was here? Kurt?
The whirling dervish, you know. He turned his back to the hitter and leg kick and that screw around delivery. He was baffling. He was there. And the people loved him. Louis.
It was like Pedro pitching here. And it was a religious experience when he was pitching that night, wasn't it?
Yeah.
This is Todd Zeal. What did they say? That you could be sure if Tiant pitched a complete game, and you were one of 35,000 people in the park, you could be sure that at some point during the game, he would look you directly in the eye during one of his windups.
That's right. He looked everywhere. Incidentally, I read something about you.
Me?
And you were a young guy, a student at Brown. You went to Brown University.
Yes, I did, Kurt.
I was doing the 75 World Series. Joe Morgan was playing second base for the Reds, and you were up in the booth. I didn't know you then. But they tell me you were a skinny guy with long hair.
I know it was a long time ago.
And a Louis Tiant mustache. Boy, that must have been a sight.
I've seen this picture.
Save me, Daddy.
It's pretty scary. Hey, Kurt, now, wait a minute. Here it is. They found this. I got to give our guys in the archives now. There you, Kubek and Gradual and Kurt. Now, wait. No, somewhere. Wait a minute. There it is. Is that? Oh, God. That's very scary. I look like that, huh? Really, what do you think? Skinny, long hair, Louis? Here it is again. Joe, what do you think of this? You recognize that guy?
You have to remember, I've seen photos of you when you were with your long hair and the mustache. I've seen photos of you like that.
You had to bring that up, didn't you, Kurt? I wish I'd saved some of that. I wish I'd saved some of that hair. I mean, it's got to be in a pillowcase somewhere.
That would have helped you in television.
That was, we'll get to that later innings on that series, which involves you two gentlemen more than me. I got paid $25 a game to be at that thing and be a runner, you know that?
Okay.
Cash.
Did they pay you that well, Joe, at that time? Yeah, I was a runner for NBC. It's true. And Kurt, it was a thrill just to listen to you and be 6 feet behind you and...
Not 6 feet under.
Oh, no, that'll be later. But being in the park for those games, although Joe broke everybody's heart. Now, here's one that Wakefield bounces past Mirabella. It's going to happen.
Well, it happened here, I think, because he is worried about Mondesi at first base. They pitched out on the first pitch, and then he comes and he doesn't stop. He just kind of continues his motion. He's trying to trick Mondesi because he probably thought he was going and he rushed his delivery. No, see that he didn't even stop. That should have been a balk, to be honest with you. He didn't stop. You have to have a pause, as they call it. But he just came up and broke his hands if he's playing catch.
Chuo to Soriano. When does a knuckleballer not want to throw a knuckleball? I mean, you know, he can't throw every pitch.
But there's a difference. I remember, I'll give you an example. Tom Candiotti, He said to me one day, he said, Joe, I am a pitcher that happens to throw a knuckleball. Well, Wakefield is a knuckleball pitcher, meaning all he's going to throw you are knuckleballs unless, he threw two knuckleballs to Raul Mondesi, and he's thrown all knuckleballs here to Soriano, even the 2-0 pitch. So he's a knuckleball pitcher. That means he's going to throw you 99% knuckleballs. Whereas, as I said about Candiotti, he threw you other pitches.
He almost threw a knuckleball to second base, Joe.
Well, you can see him try to change his grip and throw to second, but a good job there by Walker to keep it from going into the outfield.
Who had the best knuckleball, in your opinion, that you saw, Kurt?
We didn't have many. Trying to think of the fellow with the white side. Yeah, Hoyt Wilhelm.
Hoyt Wilhelm?
Yeah, he had a darn good knuckleball. Incidentally, Joe, can a knuckleball pitcher last longer? Is there less strain on his arm throwing a knuckleball?
Well, yes, they say it's less strain on your arm, especially your elbow, because when you're throwing a slider, you're torquing your elbow. When you're throwing a good fastball, you're doing the same thing. There's a lot of pull on your elbow and your shoulder.
Of course, two of the best knuckleball pitchers were brothers, the Negroes, and early on, when Wakefield first came to the Red Sox, he became with the Pirates, they got Phil Negro, Hall of Famer, 300 wins, to come in and just work with him, and really he helped straighten him out. The knuckleball was going south, if that's possible, and he credits Negro with a big assist for helping him revive what he had started pretty well when he came up out of nowhere with Pittsburgh.
I'm going to ask Joe this. Why aren't there more knuckleball pitchers?
Well, because it is difficult to control. I mean, it's like, by the way, the overhand curveball, very few pitchers throw that nowadays because it's harder to control. They throw the slider because they can control it better. And it's very difficult to control the knuckleball because you do not know where it's going. And secondly, a lot of teams do not want knuckleball pitchers because of wild pitches, etc. And they know that you're in a tight game, that you're at disadvantage if you have a knuckleball pitcher out there. If you can stay close to a knuckleball pitcher, that's always been the saying, as you see the ball just tumbles, you can beat him. That's kind of the key that most people have, is that if you stay close, you can beat him.
Cal Soriano stayed close, hits that one into center field. Mondesi being waved around, and we got a tie game at 2-2.
And that shows again why he is such a good hitter. He waited and he waited. He fouled off a couple of pitches, and Wakefield made a mistake. He got the ball up a little bit, and he stayed right on it. He didn't. And watch, this is not a hard swing. See that? He just guides that ball in the left center field. This is not the swing that hit 39 home runs last year. You can see he cuts down on his swing. It's a pretty good pitch by Wakefield, but because he wasn't trying to pull it, not trying to do too much, he was able to line it to center field. That shows the experience that he's gained in the last couple of years as a hitter.
So here is Derek Jeter, who came back a week ago yesterday after being injured in the very first inning of the season in Toronto. Collision with the catcher Huckabee of the Blue Jays. And so Jeter was one for one at the time. If you're going to be hurt, Kurt, for 6 weeks, you might as well be hitting 1,000.
That's right. Jeter started in spring training. Steinbrenner got on him in the press, and I thought it was rather unfair, but
so did Derek.
Yeah. First time I think Derek was ever questioned as a player with the Yankees.
And I think that what had happened is, if you look at Derek's career, each year though his batting average had gone down each and every year, and I think, you know, I'm not trying to get in George's mind, but maybe it was a wake-up call, you know what I mean? Yeah, and say, hey, you know, I want the Derek Jeter we had 3 years ago. Although we all know that the guy plays hard every day, he's kind of the leader of this team. I mean, he's the guy that I said, you know, 4 years ago, I thought he was going to be the captain of the Yankees one of these days. And I think that's, you know, George is George. But I if you look at his batting average and stuff, he had dropped each and every year the last 3 years. And maybe it's just a wake-up call was needed, and hopefully he'll bounce back to where he was 3 years ago.
You know, as I'm watching this here, one thing Wakefield does, considering how slow the knuckleball comes to the plate, does a good job of holding the runners on. I mean, Soriano may go and steal a base. Right?
Well, he cheats because he doesn't stop all the time. You're supposed to stop. So he stops this time. Next time he may not. He didn't stop when Mondesi took off. And I shouldn't say he cheats. I mean, he's being a veteran. He's doing what he can get away with. if you're a base dealer, you say cheating. But truthfully, I mean, he changes what he does out there, and that's the only defense that he really has, is to be able to change the speed to the plate.
2-2 to Jeter. Giambiu homered on deck. Derek waits this one out, but gets under it. Coming on, Johnny Damon makes the catch. Soriano back to first. Yeah, you know, we're some of the memories of you here, Kurt, with Ted Williams. I know with two outs, we don't want to get started on too much, but
first baseman,
you got to watch Williams. Now, you weren't the voice of the Red Sox in the 40s, but you got to watch Williams for a decade, day in, day out. What more than anything else was the best, what made him great?
His pride. He had great pride. He wanted to be the best. He worked at being the best. And he's still the most competent man I've ever met. Whatever he did, he was the best at it. Fishing, flying a jet plane, hitting a baseball. I mean, he had a great attention to detail, practice, studied. Nobody ever worked harder at his craft than Ted Williams did.
I want to get this in because you told us something very interesting at lunch today about your friendship with Ted, but how he helped you as a broadcaster, perhaps.
Yeah, I'll talk about that in a minute. As I watched him prepare and practice and work and everything, I said to myself, why can't I prepare more? Why can't I be like him? So I started to keep more records and notebooks and talk to more players and prepare more. And I told him, I said, Ted, you helped make me a better broadcaster. What do you mean? He said, I don't know anything about broadcasting. Well, I said, I watched the way you worked and prepared. And he said, well, I'll give you that. And he said, what's the matter with trying to be better or trying to be the best? Nothing's wrong.
Nothing's wrong with that. Nothing. You're right. And some people might think, well, he was a little cocky when he said, when he wanted people to look down the street and say, there goes the greatest hitter that ever lived. That's part of what you're talking about. He wanted people to know that he was the best and think of him as the best. And you know what? A lot of people probably did say that when he walked down the street.
Yeah.
There goes the runner, Soriano, and that time he gets in there. So Soriano, with two outs, moving for Alfonso. That is stolen base number 11.
Well, it's three balls and one strike, and Giambi goes ahead and takes the pitch. He gives Soriano a chance to steal the base. Now he'll try to drive him in. You don't like to do that with one strike to put yourself in the hole, but he did it anyway.
Oh, boy. Whatever Jason was struggling with, hitting 200 against everybody who wasn't a knuckleballer, Joe, Maybe he could sign up to face a knuckleballer every night.
Well, the reason he gets away with this pitch is because it's in a little bit. If that pitch is away or out over the plate, he would have probably hit another home run. But that ball moved in at the last moment, and he had to pull it foul. But that's what a knuckleball does. It moves late. Oh, beautiful pitch.
And it moved late into the strike zone. And Wakefield has ended all three innings with a punch out. We're tied at two, heading to the bottom of the third. Roger Clemens on the hill, facing the Red Sox in the bottom of the third inning. It's a 2-2 game. And the 2-3-4 hitters for Boston, Todd Walker, Nomar Garcia-Para, who had a two-run homer in the first. And Manny Ramirez up. Walker singled, and he was aboard when Nomar went deep, very deep. And Walker up the middle with a base hit, so Todd is on twice. We have more baseball tonight as we go out west with Giants, who had a 6-0 lead. It's Arizona get five, but the Giants won it last night at Arizona. That's 10 Eastern and 7 out west. ESPN2 tonight, Jason Schmidt, who, Joe, you and I saw pitch a brilliant game a couple of weeks ago on the hill tonight for the Giants. So here is Nomar.
Well, he now has, a 22-game hitting streak?
Mm-hmm.
The all-time Red Sox record is held by Don DiMaggio, 34. And he's a wonderful friend of mine, a great guy. 34 games in a row he hit in. Second, I think, was Chris Peeker with 30. And
I think Nomar tied him
with 30 once, didn't
his
he?
His rookie
yeah,
year.
He tied him. He tied him with 30.
Those are pretty good names, Dom DiMaggio and Tris Speaker.
Yeah, I think Dom DiMaggio belongs in the Hall of Fame. He didn't hit 300. He had 298, but he's a great fielder. Marvelous leadoff batter, hit with power, 80-90 RBIs, and could run. He was limited in center field here because of the short park. You put him in the big outfield, and I'm going to tell you, he made catches that were breathtaking.
He also made an all-star team seven times.
Yeah.
You know, who was so vocal about that was your late great friend Ted Williams. I mean, he would be every year. I can't believe Tom is not in the Hall of Fame.
Well, David Halberstrom and my friend, a great writer, had just written a book about these four guys, Williams, Dorr, DiMaggio, and Pesky, how their friendship has lasted 60 years. 60 years. And all of them were real great guys. I love Ted Williams. People didn't know him, they misunderstood him, but he was a very loyal friend to you and a go-through guy.
No, I don't know if I ever told you this, but, you know, growing up, you know, I idolized Ted Williams. Jackie Robinson, of course, and Nellie Fox. And I loved Ted Williams when I used to watch him on TV because he seemed like he was bigger than life. He seemed like he was bigger than all the other players, and he just seems, you know, so great.
He was an American hero in my book.
And, you know, you talk about Bobby Dorr. He's like my favorite guy. You know, I see him at the Hall of Fame all the time. And, you know, Bobby Dorr, another great player here in Boston and a good friend. He used to have me kid Ted Williams all the time when we go to the Hall of Fame every year about swinging down on the ball. They used to have this argument every day, he said.
Bobby Dorr, number four, one of the members retired here that we just saw. Roger pitching Nomar a little differently that time. Posada grabs it. And there is one out. You know, we Roger now, all right, on the precipice of 300 wins, which if he wins tonight, his next attempt would be on Memorial Day against these very same Red Sox in Yankee Stadium, a game we'll have for you on ESPN. A 300 game where, and Kurt, the list is so long of pitchers that you've seen. Who come to mind as ones that you just would want pitching for you, the best pitchers that you saw?
I had to win one game, and I was a manager. I would pick Bob Gibson of the Cardinals. Now, people argue with that, but I want to tell you, boy, he'd be on that mound looking in, and he was mean.
Yeah.
And he was competitive, and he was a great basketball player at Creighton University. And he could field his position better than anybody, and he had a great fastball, and he knocked you down. He'd do anything to win.
That's a good point. He wanted to win. He was the greatest competitor. And Bob Gibson had a way about him, Kurt. When you stood in the batter's box and you looked out there, he looks back at you, and his eyes were telling you can't hit me. I mean, yeah. That was Bob Gibson.
Here they are. Here are your names.
Yeah, here.
Robert Feller, huh?
Yeah, Bob Feller. He was a great young fireballer. Warren Spahn, people forget how great he was. He won 300 and what, 63?
Right.
Imagine that. And at the age of 42, he won 22 games in the season. He was great. Koufax for 5 years was as good as anybody. And a pitcher I really thought was great was Steve Carlton.
Right.
The Cardinals made a dumb trade and traded him over to the Phillies.
Bottom busted out there. You know, just to show where, going back to Gibson and Feller, you know, all-time wins, Bob Gibson, 251. You know, Roger Clemens, 298. I'm just trying to put it in perspective because we all know what Bob Gibson was. Bob Feller. And it was about this. Bob Feller won 266. You know, a great story, talking with Joe Torre before the game. He caught Warren Spahn's 300th win.
He did?
Yes, he was 21 years old. Spahn was 40-something. Joe was so excited. It was in Milwaukee against the Cubs, and it was 2-1, and a name you brought up. Oh, he busted both of those guys, didn't he? The name you brought up, Joe, earlier, he said, here's Eddie Matthews, so excited. We get two outs. There's a ground ball to third. Matthews is so excited. It's the final out. And he threw it into the stands. But he said Spahn and got the last out. We all went out, and he had the restaurant down. He said, we all went out, you know, celebrating for Spahn.
And he said, and there was when we got done at whatever time it was at night, Charlie Dressen, the manager, was standing there watching what time we got done. Caught his 300th win.
It's interesting, your list there, I faced everyone on that list with the exception of Bob Feller. Gibson, Koufax, of course, Steve Carlton. I faced all those guys. And we, you know, a couple of guys you had just below that on your list. You know, we talked about Marichal. We talked about a lot of great pitchers. And there have been a lot of great pitchers in Major League Baseball. And the game has really changed. But today, if you're a power pitcher, Pedro Martinez, Roger Clemens, those are the guys that seem to be the most successful.
You know, when you start making lists or picking the five best or the 10, there's always three or four guys just off that list
right.
that really belong on the list.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, right on the corner.
I don't think anyone would argue with those five you
no,
listed.
No, I don't think so.
And here's Bob Gibson, who, well, in this park, broke the hearts. He won three games in the 67 series against the Red Sox.
Won the deciding game.
On short rest.
Right here.
You think Clemens is mean like that? Like Gibson?
I think nobody was as mean as he was.
Well, I don't mean as mean. But is that part of what makes him great, guys?
Yeah, well, I don't think he was a mean man, but
no.
He was mean on the mound.
There's a thin line in professional sports, and that line is crossed over as an intimidation. You know, the difference between, you know, being a great pitcher, say, and a very good pitcher, sometimes is the intimidation factor, being able to intimidate hitters. And I don't think there's any doubt that Roger Clemens does intimidate hitters. And Bob Gibson definitely intimidated hitters. But Bob always tells me he hit fewer guys than most of, you know, the pitchers during his era. He said he just pitched inside.
Yeah, well, fewer guys were even close to the plate against him, right?
Yeah, well, his thought was, and I don't mean this because I had long conversations with him about this. He said, look, the outside part of the plate was mine. If you go out there, then I got to take yours. The inside, he said, if you're going out there to get my part, I've got to come inside, take some of yours away. So that was his philosophy. And let's face it, I mean, Pedro, who we think is one of the best pitchers in the game today, he's not afraid to pitch inside. Roger Clemens pitched inside. Randy Johnson, Curt Schilling,
yeah,
all
look,
the top
I watch these games, you guys, and somebody pitches inside or hits the batter and they glare out there and then they rush to the mound and start swinging. I don't get it.
No.
Huh?
Well, it's a little different now.
Hey, Roger has it. Listen, look, guys, Roger, we know that Roger certainly has it in him. That's, of course, the 1990, I don't want to call it a meltdown, out at Oakland in the ALCS when Terry Cooney was the umpire. He went nuts. And then, of course, with the bat in the World Series with Piazza. I mean, Roger has had his own flare-ups.
Yeah.
Right?
They all do.
Well, all the real competitive pitchers will. I mean, that's part of being a competitor.
That's going to be just fine.
There's a happy young fellow. He'll go home with a real souvenir of tonight.
We got had a couple of nights up here. They're pretty nice. But we just got reminded it's been a long winter up here in New England, and the chill has come back, huh?
Worst winter they ever had up here.
Yeah, talk to my left knee about it. Posadas throws a whirly bird in the center field. Milardo will get the stolen base, so the Hey, wait a minute. We just put up, he had his first stolen base in 4 years the last time. Yeah, I'm having so much fun that I forgot it was on base. See, Kurt, bail me out next inning, will you please?
That's Todd Walker.
Todd Walker. Well, I'm going to get Millar on. He's going to steal another one.
Okay. But that was,
I was so excited to talk about it.
Well, that was a real high throw. I mean, the ball looked like it might have slipped out of his hand.
Well, maybe next.
Not let you
maybe
on.
Next time. See, I tell you what, I've just flubbed. So, Kurt, can we get a professional in here to call play-by-play? You want to do it the next?
Yeah, I'll call somebody in there. Can I?
You're in.
everybody. I'm Kurt Gowdy. Welcome to the World Series. There's a drive up the middle. Hernandez is back in the bag. He's going. Jesse Hernandez. Look at Blast. Blast has picked the Pirates to the World Championship.
Well, Cliff, get a 1-0 pitch. They're jamming out on the field. His teammates are waiting for him. The ball hit the foul pole.
Your days used to hit more to right, right center than the left. There's a long drive. Ball's in deep. Deep. It is gone. He did it. He did it.
One out, nobody on. Last of the eighth inning.
And he came up for that last time at bat. That was maybe my big thrill at broadcast.
Williams swings, and there's a long drive to deep right.
Brought baseball to us far and wide, whether you listen to the Yankees in 49 or 50 or the Red Sox in the 50s or 60s or the game of the week or the World Series. And I'm going to stop at baseball. All right. Is that really you, Kurt Gowdy? It is our treat to listen to you call here the middle innings of the Yankees and the Red Sox.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you very much. Well, I haven't done a game in 25 years, but I'll take a whack.
We're not too concerned.
But we got a two-strike count now on Bernie Williams. Score tied, 2-2. We're in the top of the fourth inning. Wakefield is the pitcher for the Red Sox. Just missed. Letter high outside. 1-2. Wakefield's done all right so far. The outfield straight away for Williams. Here's the pitch, and it's a looper in the center. Clemens waiting out there. 1-1.
I'm going to ask you a question because you told us about, we just saw you call the Ted Williams last home run. Yeah. You knew a secret on that, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I came into the ballpark that day. This was the last home game for the Red Sox of the 1960 season. They still had 3 games left in New York City for the weekend.
Matsui's
up. I started through the Red Sox clubhouse, and Johnny Orlando, the Red Sox clubhouse boy, hey, Gowdy, come here, called me over. There's the strike, and he said, this is the kid's last game ever. I said, what do you mean? We have 3 left in New York. He said, no, he's got a chest cold, and Mr. Yawkey and Cronin have excused him. This will be his last game he's ever going to play. But you can't tell anybody. As I promise, I won't, Johnny. So, we're up there. We have a brief ceremonies at home plate. And it's in there. We got him. Matsui strikes out. I don't think he saw a knuckle like that in Japan.
No.
2 down, nobody on, and Posada comes up. So anyway, Williams went out the first 3 times. He hit a long fly his 3rd time up the deep right field. Came up for the 4th time. The fans are on their feet. They had 300,000 people there that day.
Yeah.
Everybody was here.
Everybody was there that told me for 20 years that I was there for Ted's last game. They had 10,000, actually. It was a cold, raw day. A strike to Posada. And then here comes the pitch, a 2-1 pitch by Fisher, and he hit a high drive in the deep right field. I knew it was going. It landed in the grandstand. The 1-strike pitch. Ground ball out to 2nd. Walker scoops and throws in the sides out. 1-2-3. What's the cue for the commercial?
Whatever you want it to be. I'll tell you what.
Here comes the commercial.
My life is ruined.
Give me a hug.
Critics are falling for the in-laws.
We're fine.
Michael Douglas and Albert Brooks are hilarious together.
Trot Nixon leads off for the Red Sox in the last of the 4th inning and looks at a ball. To complete that Williams story, when he rounded first base, I said, and Ted Williams has hit a home run in his last time at bat in the major leagues. I broke my word to Johnny Orlando.
You know, we heard that in the broadcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was in his last at bat. It's pretty interesting.
2-0.
Hey.
One of my big thrills in broadcasting.
You had to let everybody know that.
Sure. Ground ball. It got by the first baseman in the right field. Giambi couldn't come up with it, and Nixon is on with a single. So the Red Sox now have Shea Hildenbrand.
Well, this ball's hit sharply. I mean, it looks like a little slider down and in. Giambi tries to knock it down, but it hits off his wrist and bounces on it in the right field for a base hit.
Five hits for the Red Sox, two hits for the Yankees. Score tied 2-2, last of the fourth. Runner on first, nobody out. And Hildenbrand up. He grounded out to short his first time. Looked at a strike. Nothing on one.
Kind of like riding a bicycle, huh?
Hit 306 this year. He's a dangerous guy at the plate.
Yes, he is. He's having a good year.
Yeah, well, he started off hot last year and sort of tailed off. The one strike delivery. Just a little inside. One ball, one strike. What's this strike zone thing you guys got on TV now, or this diagram?
Oh, the K zone.
The K zone?
Yeah, we basically, you don't have to worry about it tonight. We're going to use it on Sunday.
We don't use it on Wednesday night. I don't allow it in.
Do not show it tonight.
You're with me.
I don't want to see it.
on Sunday nights.
You have to watch Joe and John on Sunday nights, Kirk. Wednesday night, you're safe.
What do they do?
Well,
you don't want to get into it, huh?
No.
Okay. 1-1 the count to Shea Hildenbrand at first base. It's Trot Nixon with the foul ball. It's 1-2 now. Fourth inning, game tied 2-2. You know, Clemens broke the all-time strike record here in this park when he was a young pitcher, 20. 10 years later, he struck out 20 again.
Amazing.
Tie his own record. Now, 10 years apart, you know, you think a guy would be going downhill from that first time, but he kept that pace up. 1-2 pitch. Foul away into the seats.
You know, when I watch Clemens, I always remember something Nolan Ryan said. Nolan Ryan said, I came in as a power pitcher. I'm going to leave as a power pitcher. And that's what Roger Clemens has done. And he's been able to keep his velocity up during that 10-year period you're talking about, where he struck out 20 and then 20 a second time. So, and I think it all has to do with, if you look at Roger Clemens, Nolan Ryan, Tom Seaver, all those guys that threw hard late, they all had big legs.
Hot ground to the third, great play. Throw to second for one, Soriano to first, and it's a double play. Oh, the bases are now empty. And Bill Mueller will come up.
Well, it's a nice play at third by Ventura. He gets the ball over to Soriano real quickly. Look at that throw. Soriano comes across the bag, has plenty of time to avoid the runner, and then he has a strong enough arm that he can throw on the run. But Robin Ventura's won a gold gloves for his work at third base, so nice turn there.
Bill Mueller, the batter, up to the ball. Now, how do you rate Soriano as a fielding second baseman?
Well, he's still learning. I mean, he's much better this year than he was the first couple of years. But, you know, he's getting better. He's made four errors this year, but he took a long time before he made a couple this year. He's much, much better, and it just comes with experience. I mean, he's going to get better and better, and I think he's going to get better as a hitter, too. He's becoming more patient. I mean, I think there's no ceiling on what he can do as a baseball player and as a second baseman.
2-0 the count to Bill Mueller. Two out, nobody on, game tied. 2-2, there's the strike by Clemens. Clemens tonight has struck out four. And throwing hard. Little fly ball out to short, leaps up, can't get it, catches Leaguer in the left field. Miller's on. Two down. It's two hits for the Red Sox this inning. But they had a double play in between, and Mirabelli comes up.
Well, a fastball in. He jams Miller, but Miller fights it off, and he gets a little flare, as Kurt said, a Texas leaguer. I played in the Texas League, so I know what you mean.
I broadcast there for 4 years. Listen, that was a very good minor league.
It was. I went from the Texas League to the big league, so it was a good minor league.
Stayed in Texas. Right,
yeah,
Joe?
Yeah.
I remember Dizzy Dean got married at home plate in Houston. He was in the Texas League. They used to send a lot of the sore arm pitchers to major league clubs down there because it was so hot. Texas, Oklahoma, Arkansas, and a lot of the pitchers recovered down there with the heat on their arm and, you know, had some good ball players. I broadcast a team that had the batting champ one year. The guy had the first night he had four doubles in the opening game of the season. Al Rosen, remember him?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and he went on to win the league batting title.
Cleveland Indians.
One of the pitchers was Mike Garcia.
Cleveland Indians.
Cleveland Indians. And a very unusual happening was Ray Boone was a catcher. In June, they converted him to a shortstop. That is a real conversion.
Yes, it is.
And I want to tell you something. He used to hit over 400 in this ballpark when the Indians would come in. Oh, he would almost tear this wall down. He was a very dangerous hitter and a good shortstop. And his boys now are managing and
grandsons aren't bad.
Yeah.
Well, I know Ray's still alive. I gotta find out how to get a hold of him. I'd like to say hello to him.
Well, he just did.
Yeah, he just did.
Ray, if you're listening, hello. Pitch. Maribali takes it. A strike, 2-1 count, two out. On first base is Bill Miller. The game tied 2-2, last of the fourth. We're moving along. Clemens is throwing hard tonight.
Yeah, that was a very good fastball there. When he gets behind 2-0, he seems to reach back, get a little extra on his fastball.
Right in there. Call strike, 2-2 count. 20 strikeouts in the game. That is a lot.
There's only 27 outs.
It's ridiculous.
And to do it twice, 10 years apart, that's amazing. Let's say he's 22, 23. Now he's in his 30s when he does it again. Meaning he's lost nothing on his fastball.
Yeah. He had 10 strikeouts his last outing with the Yanks. So he's getting close to 4,000.
Bill Miller on first, two down. The batter, Doug Maribali. Last to the fourth, the game tied 2-2. Clemens is ready. Throw to first. Sliding back is Miller. As I told you earlier, the Red Sox are a different team this year. They don't have the all-around power they used to have, but they got a more consistent batting order. They get men on base, they score more runs. They're a pesky team that way. Fouled away.
Well, before they seemed to be built for this ballpark and they do well here and then they go on the road and obviously couldn't compete.
I'll tell you a story. Joe Cronin and I were sitting in the stands one day when I was a young announcer here. He was a general manager and we were watching batting practice and he said to me, put his arm around me, Kurt, this is a very crazy little park to build a winner in.
Good point.
Yeah. The 2-2 pitch. Lucked him out. So, no runs, two hits, one man left at the end of four. It's 2-2 at Fenway Park. Robin Ventura leads off for the Yankees in the fifth inning. Wakefield's first pitch is a strike to him. Ventura struck out his first time up. Actually, Wakefield is out pitch Clemens so far, but the score is tied. Little bounding ball down to first base. Up with it and over is Hildenbrand, and there's one wild. One away. And Mondesi, Roel Mondesi will be the next man up.
Mondesi.
Tim Wakefield, I see him down in Florida in the winter. I'm a sort of a host of a great fishing tournament down there called the Red Bone Classic. And he fishes in it every year in Isle of Ramada, Florida. You have to catch a red bone, a redfish and a bonefish to qualify for the championship. He's a pretty good fisherman.
Do his fish flutter on the line? No. When you pull him out of the water?
You know what? If he had that knuckleball on his lure, he'd do a lot better. I got to remind him of that. Get a knuckleball lure. One out, nobody on. On to see the batter. Zeal on deck. Slips that in for a strike call. He's doing pretty good, Joe.
Yeah, he's throwing well. And he seems to have good control of his knuckleball. I mean, he's not falling behind where he has to take something off.
He struck him out. That one really danced around.
One problem you have as a hitter is when a knuckleball pitcher gets two strikes on you and he's ahead in the count, he's going to throw it harder and make it dance more. And you can see that ball just tumbles right at the end, just drops.
That was strikeout number 5 for Wakefield. Todd Zeal is now the hitter. He flied out to right field. This is the bottom of the order for the Yankees. Score tied 2-2. 2 runs, 6 hits for the Red Sox. 2 runs, 2 hits for the Yankees. We have no errors in the game. A pitch just a little inside. Soriano on deck. 1-0 pitch. 1-1 the count now.
You know, Kurt, you're a little higher up than you used to be when you announced
the
game.
Oh, yeah. I was way down below. Right off the press box. I had to crawl down a shift ladder. The high fly and a shallow left. Back goes shortstop Garcia Pera. Has it, and the Yankees are down 1-2-3. So at the end of 4.5 innings, the score is tied 2-2. We're at the top of the Red Sox batting order. Johnny Damon is leading off. And it's inside to him. He is grounded out. He's lined out to short, and he's popped up. 0-2. He's followed by Todd Walker and then Garcia Pera. Now feel a little bit toward left for him. The infield in at first and third. He's a very good bunter. That pitch is a strike. 1-1. Any good bunters left in baseball?
No, very few. There's only a couple of guys who bunt. And as you said, Johnny's one of those guys, but very few. Hey, this is the era of the home run. Everybody's swinging for the home run, even the singles hitters.
Yeah, Ty Cobb got mad at Ruth for ruining the old
ruined the game.
He was the master of the one-run game, the hit and run. Ruth came along and swish and gone. It's all over.
Well, it's now the, you know, good pitching, defense, and the 3-run homer. That's kind of the way the game is built.
2-1 pitch. Fly ball, right field, waiting for it. Is Mondesi, and he has it, and there's one down.
You said at the beginning of the game, Kurt, it ruined the Red Sox, right?
Yeah.
Babe was gone.
Yeah.
We had 29 homers that one year with the Yankees. Like, what is he doing? 29?
You know, one year, I think it was 50, the Red Sox had a team, first team on the field, batting average of .310. A team
the
average.
Whole team.
The whole team. Then the whole squad, I think, had an average of .301 or two. Boy, they had great hitters. There they are driving a center base hit. Williams up with it on the hop.
A shortstop. Walker 3-for-2. There he is.
There's the king. You imagine if he played now in the television days, how much money he'd make.
But say he's already the most popular player in the history of the game. Just think what it would have been if they could have seen him every day, huh?
Yeah, doing how many endorsements would he get? Huh?
Won 100 games as a pitcher.
Yeah, he was something. Came out of an orphanage in Baltimore. Dad owned a bar there. I guess Babe learned how to use it. Foul ball. Garcia Pera hit a home run to extend his batting streak to 22 in a row. He's popped up. They're tied up 2-2. The Red Sox have one out, and on first base is Todd Walker. Clemens set to deliver. Moves him back. 1-1 tag.
Well, you had to know that was coming sooner or later after the guy hit the home run the first inning. You're going to move him off the plate a little bit.
You know what I don't get, though, as I watch these games, a fellow maybe hits the guy in the arm or nicks him in the leg or comes close. High pop-up out in shallow center. Soriano back coming on. But Bernie Williams, he falls down.
Uh-oh.
He hurt himself?
Well, he
made a hell of a catch. I know that.
Well, he might have slipped down just to make sure that he didn't extend himself. Let's see here. See, he's slowing down, and then he just seemed to lose his footing, so he went down. But I'm sure it did hurt him a little bit. You can see him grimace there.
Yeah. Soriano caught the ball, actually.
Yep, Soriano makes the catch.
Two down, runner on first.
And he is in some discomfort out there. He's walking around trying to walk it off.
Well, we had a drizzle all afternoon, so the turf is slippery. Ramirez has struck out twice against Clemens. Ramirez has had a little bit of power shortage so far this season. Hitting over 300, but he's not hitting that long ball like he usually does.
He's not talking to anybody either, at least the media. That's never happened in Boston.
302.
Media and a ball player not getting along.
Six home runs.
Well, I guess Nomar's not talking either. At least that's what Roger
said. Pedro's not.
Yeah, Pedro's not.
I don't know. I went in there and talked to Doug Mirabelli, Joe.
Oh, you got to talk to Doug. That was an interesting release today. You know, Roger Clemens, they asked him some questions about the Red Sox and 300. It was kind of interesting.
1-0, the count to Ramirez. Runner on first, two down. Last of the fifth inning. Game tied 2-2. Throw to first, and back is Walker.
Now, Roger left the Red Sox not on great terms, but no one has worn his number 21 since he left. So, you know, maybe one of these days, you know, they can make up.
Well, they used to boo him heavily when he first came in here with Toronto and then the Yankees. It sort of quieted down now. A 1-0 pitch. All the way.
Well, Roger really said, right, Kurt and Joe, is that, hey, Boston has been a big part of my life. I don't have any bad feelings at this point. I loved it here.
I think he had a lot of good friends up here. Mm-hmm. And he was an affable guy. And got four boys, you know. That's a fistful.
All beginning with K.
Yeah.
Which is fitting. He did say that among his friends here was a pretty good bartender, speaking of Babe Ruth. And he said, maybe I can have him keep the Yankees out the night before I pitch. I mean, the Red Sox out the night before I pitch. I don't know if that happened.
We have a 2-1 count on Manny Ramirez. On first base is Todd Walker. They're two down. He's still throwing hard, Joe.
Yes, he is. And actually, he's throwing harder now than he was at the beginning of the ball game. He seemed to have found his groove out there.
Two-one delivery. Fly ball, center field, easy chance for Bernie Williams. Tucks it away, and the Red Sox have no runs. One hit, there were no errors, one man left. Score at the end of five, Red Sox 2, Yankees 2.
ESPN HD, sponsored by Philips and Best Buy.
Look, Steph, it's adorable. Hi there. Hi. What kind is it?
It's a mix, actually. Oh. Part charcoal, part gas.
Does it do any tricks?
This is so yeah. Weird, actually, it switches from gas to charcoal in just a few seconds.
Listen, Steph and I are having a party tonight. Why don't you stop by?
The Charbroil 2-in-1 Charcoal Gas Grill. It's man's new best friend.
What a chick magnet.
No way.
Never seen an angel with wings?
No.
Ever heard of 1-800-COLLECT?
Who has it? When you want to call collect, dial 1-800-COLLECT.
Braun Ambrex. I like that. 1-800-COLLECT. Save a buck or two.
He did it! He did it! Well, our living legend is right here to the right of me and to the left of Joe Morgan. It's Kurt Gowdy, and we have, it is like riding a bike, isn't it, Kurt?
Happy to have you keep going as long as you want. 2-2 here in the sixth.
Okay. Soriano is leading off for the Yankees, top of the sixth inning. He's popped up and he's singled. He's stolen the base. This young man is a find for the Yankees, Joe.
You're right. And I talked to Joe Torre a couple of years ago, Kirk, because, you know, he struggled his first year with playing defense and they were thinking about moving him to left field. And I basically talked to Joe. I said, I think he can play second base, just leave him there, let him work and whatever. And the next year I came by and Joe said he was going to leave him there, and it's worked out very well because I think he's going to be a great second baseman.
Pops it up. Calling for it. Second baseman Walker. And takes it. One down. Nobody on. And Wakefield is really moving along. Let's see. He's retired.
Derek.
3, 6, 7, 8 in a row. Must have that knuckling, Joe.
Well, it's moving. Well, when they hit somebody like Soriano on the fist, you know he's dancing because he handles the ball inside very well.
Cheater's up. He's grounded out. He's flying out. We're tied 2-2. We're in the top of the sixth inning here at Fenway Park. He wanted to go for it and let it go. It's a strike. As I said, the knucklers used to tell me they love it when the wind is blowing out so they can throw that knuckler into the wind or into a breeze. Look at them. They're not, the cedar, they're just not getting that bat on the ball.
Well, you can't. They're not having good swings, and that's because this ball is dancing so much. But again, you know, you're saying the knuckleball, when it's going against the wind, it really dances more. And you can see it. The ball tumbles. You never know where it's going to end up. And that's what makes it so difficult to hit. And
I remember maybe you can help me here, Joe. The Orioles used to have a knuckleball pitcher.
I got it. I thought of him before. Eddie Watt. Is that him?
I don't know.
Is that him?
I don't know.
Gus Triandis was the catcher.
Yeah, you're right. I'm trying to think, too.
I thought of him a couple innings ago. Well, meanwhile,
Peter strikes out.
Yeah, he's not thinking about Eddie Watt.
Anyway, one day I went to the Baltimore clubhouse after the game, and Triandis was there. There's a strike. And Triandis had his shirt off, and I'm telling you, he was black and blue, and he's chested
trying
everywhere.
Trying to catch it, huh?
Trying to catch that knuckleball. Hit him all over the body.
Eddie Fisher. Is that familiar?
Yeah, that's familiar.
That sounds something.
That's like familiar
it.
With me. Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. Yeah, Eddie Fisher.
Jason Giambi looks at a strike. Two down, nobody on. Game tied, 2-2, top of the sixth inning. The pitch is a strike call. And now he's ahead 0-2, and he's throwing strikes.
Well, he's really in control of this ball game. His ball is moving well, and he's keeping the hitters off balance. I think they're being fooled just as much with the speed as they are the movement of the ball.
Another pop-up. Going out is Garcia Pera. He's got it. And the Yankees again are down 1-2-3. Wakefield is really hot right now. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. The score is 2-2.
There's a state that's utterly free, where the national pastime is the game of what if. What if all cars were turbocharged? What if innovation were the official currency? What if every road were an opportunity? Saabs are made in a state of independence, where freedom is held as tightly as the road. Welcome.
Reese Davis, Rob Dibble with you in the studio. Cubs and Pirates, and Kerry Wood getting knocked around a little bit. Jack Wilson and then Brian Giles wouldn't make it out of the sixth, Rob.
Yeah, Pittsburgh Pirates hitting .242. It's only his sixth home run in 10 starts.
There goes Giles, 5-0 Buccos in the seventh.
All right, fellas, thank you. We're back at Fenway where you just saw Kerry Wood, and we were watching Roger Clemens, the only two guys to strike out 20 in one game. And this other Red Sox fan, feel Kirk, stay on 298 forever.
Miller is up. Millar. Kevin Millar. One ball, one strike. Game tied, 2-2. Sixth inning. Red Sox at bat. Outfield straight away. Hammers it foul down the third baseline. One ball, two strikes. Both pitchers are pitching well, especially Wakefield, who now has retired 11 in a row. Mm. And he's making it look easy. Clemens hasn't been pounded around, though. He's given up seven hits, and Wakefield has given up only two hits.
Well, you said
Millar, Nixon, and Hillenbrand.
You said about the fifth inning that actually Wakefield's been pitching better tonight than Clemens, but Clemens seems to be heating up.
Well, there's a strikeout for Roger, and you talked about it earlier. Here was Roger's first 20 strikeout effort. It came here at Fenway, April 29, 1986, against the Seattle Mariners. R. Harold Reynolds among those that was in that game. And no one had seen anything like it before. And there it is, here at Fenway. That was his 24-4 season, when the K's were up left and right in Rogers' first Cy Young season of six. And then he did it again in Detroit on September 18, 1996.
Trot Nixon struck out, single to right. He didn't play yesterday. He had tightness in his legs. He's a hard-nosed ball player. He pulled a real goofer, though, several days ago. He caught a fly ball, thought it was a third out, and threw the ball into the stands. In the meantime, base runners were rounding the bases and pouring in, and three runs came in. Bounding ball to second base. Walker flips. Soriano flips to first.
And here it is, Kurt. Against Anaheim with two out. He thought it was three. Oops. Well, the ball's in the stand, so two bases. And there you go.
Yes. He said it was a dumb play. Dumbest I've ever made in my life, but I'll be back.
There's a right fielder better than him. Larry Walker did the same thing. He survived it.
And there's never been a player who's played this game that didn't forget at some time how many outs there were. It's just lucky that they didn't hit the ball to them. I mean, it's happened to just about everyone. You'll lose count out there every once in a while.
You know what, gentlemen? We're settling into a real pitching duel here.
Yes,
we are. Both pitchers are getting better as this game progresses. Two strikes, two outs, nobody on. Hillenbrand up. Game tied 2-2. Outfield straight away. Clemens comes in. Ooh, did you hear that ball popping that mitt?
Well, he's throwing harder now, Kurt, than he was at the beginning of the ball game. That's for sure.
One ball, two strikes. That's the sign of a great pitcher when his velocity increases as the game moves along. I know a lot of guys, managers say, get this guy early. Get him out of there. There's a line shot in the left field for a base hit. Fielded by Matsui. And on base now is Hillenbrand. Two down, runner on first.
Well, he had thrown him a couple of good fastballs. He tried to come down in, looked like it was a splitter. And it didn't move enough, and Hillenbrand was able to hit it into left field. But he had him 0-2. He went up and away and then tried to come back in.
Bill Miller's up. He's grounded out and singled. We're tied up, folks. 2-2, last of the sixth inning at Fenway. The winner of this game takes the lead in the Eastern Division of the American League. Powers the fastball in. Strike one. Nothing and one. Two down.
A lot of Yankee fans. Always about a third in each of the parks.
Yeah.
A third Yankee fans here in Fenway, and maybe a third Red Sox at Yankee Stadium.
When the game started, there were a lot of empty seats here, which is unusual for a Yankee Red Sox game. Ooh. There's a drive right back off the pitcher's mound in the center. Coming on to third is Hillenbrand, and holding it first is Bill Miller.
Boy, Miller's hot.
That ball got a piece of Roger, too.
Mm-hmm. Get it?
Yeah, I think it hit him on his non-pitching arm, but it did hit him. And here comes Joe Torre and the rest of the trainers and coaches out to see how he's doing.
Steve Donahue, Monahan. Everybody in the Yankees will be out of the mound here.
A third of the stands, too, maybe.
Yeah. I'm not sure where it hit him, but it definitely hit him.
I don't know what the fans were so upset about it. It got him.
That's his line drive back through the middle. And it did hit him. It looked like it hit him on his left inside, above the glove on his left arm.
Maybe if he's lucky, he just got the top part of the glove, Joe. We don't know.
Well, it didn't get him solidly because it would have dropped down.
Yeah.
The mass meeting of the Yankees on the mound.
Well, actually, the way they're acting, though, he may have gotten him on his pitching hand. Because it was taking him a long time before he was throwing. He was trying to feel comfortable with the ball in his hand.
Well, there's nobody warming either the pen. So, I mean, if Clemens can't go, we got the right guy here for some stories, Joe. But, hey, Roger doesn't want to come out of this thing. At Fenway,
no.
Chance to win 299. The runners at the corners, but he can just get a punch out and get out of here.
And Doug Mirabelli's due up next. The Red Sox catcher hitting ninth. So he's going to stay in there. The gang leaves. They had enough medical advice, didn't they?
Oh, yeah. George doesn't, you know, he doesn't skimp.
No, never happened.
That's Roger's line tonight, Kurt. He's given up a lot of hits, but after that two-run homer in the first inning to Garcia Parra, nobody else has scored, at least not yet.
Nine hits for the Red Sox, two hits for the Yankees. Last of the sixth inning. Two down, runners on first and third. And Mirabelli's doubled and struck out. He's hitting ninth. Clemens comes in. High. Fastball. Still had a lot of pop on that one, Joe.
Yeah, he's still throwing okay. I mean, I'm sure he would have come out if he was injured.
Clemens looking around, checking the bases. Nine hits for the Red Sox. And two runs. Boy. One and one. I'm at 0-2 now.
I thought it was 1-1 as well. I didn't know they called that first pitch a strike.
I didn't think so, but.
But his scoreboard's. No, it's 1-1.
One and one.
You were correct to start with. Yeah, I thought the first pitch was a ball.
Yeah, it was.
And then they put up on the scoreboard 0-2.
I thought, well, gee.
Yeah, but it was. I thought it was high.
Here's the 1-1 pitch.
Good pitch.
There's a good pitch. Describe that, why it's a good pitch, Joe.
Well, he had thrown two pitches up and away from him, and then this ball's back down and in. Watch where this pitch ends up. So he can't pull the trigger on it. It runs back inside, and that's because he had set him up with two pitches away.
Mirabelli up, runners on first and third, two down, a tie game, two all. Clemens comes in, a runner going, and that's it. He struck him out. Two strikeouts that inning for Clemens. The Red Sox, no runs, two hits, and two left at the end of six, 2-2. Hey, I enjoyed it, Chris and Joe. And here we are in the seventh, and Chris Berman.
Back to the amateurs. Wow.
Thank you.
Wow, I got introduced by Kurt Gowdy. You're not done yet. You're not done.
Yeah, you're going to stay for a while.
Extra innings.
Well, I didn't say that either. It's going to have a big finish. You know that, Kurt. Chris Berman, Joe Morgan, and Kurt Gowdy as we begin our Living Legend series on some selected Wednesday night games. And here's a little flare by Bernie Williams, and he hangs up there for Johnny Gaiman. And there is one out. All right, so you said you hadn't done play-by-play in 25 years?
Years.
Guess what? Guess what? When you have it, you have it.
Yeah, that's true.
Did it feel like getting on a bike? Seriously.
Well, you know, I know I can do better than that.
Well, we'll give you another chance sometime.
That's what Ted Williams told you, right?
Give me a shot.
All right, we'll call you back.
I got connections here at this network, right? Yeah, see if we can make that happen.
I know you do. I want to stay close to you.
Hideki Matsui. And this should be easy pickings for Hillenbrand. So that's what now, 13 in a row? Yep. Wakefield.
Wakefield's making it look too easy. I mean, it can't be that easy.
Hey, look, he's
having hit a ball hard for now since the third inning.
Yeah.
Since Soriano single. What do you tell him? You're in the dugout, you're the man. What do you tell these batters?
Well, you tell them just what I said about this earlier. You're facing a knuckleball pitcher, stay close, and you can beat him, because at some point, when he doesn't throw strikes or get ahead of you, or you get some runners on base, you can steal some bases, you can make things happen, you can change. Right now, everything is comfortable because he's throwing strikes and he's retired everyone. But, I mean, obviously, if he pitches like this the rest of the game, you're not going to have a chance. But what you do is you say, well, it's still a 2-2 ball game. We just hang tough.
And the way Wakefield is going, we brought up a name during one of the commercial breaks, Wilbur Wood, a knuckleballer who we should have spoken about right away. Started both halves of a doubleheader for the White Sox. There's Chris Hammond in the bullpen, the lefty. The reason I bring that up is Wakefield has a two-inning save for the Red Sox this year, too, and their bullpen was really going downhill by committee. They put Wakefield out, and he pitched the eighth and the ninth. He has a save in addition to being 4-1. He can do it all when he's on. Scoots past Garcia Pera. Boy, that took a high hop. And Posada has the first Yankee hit since Soriano singled in the third inning.
That ball is hit like a shot, and then not a lot of time for Garcia Parra to move. You'll see him, he just kind of waves at it because there's not a lot you can do. You don't have time to get in front of it. That's one of those knuckleballs, you could see it did not move very much, and he drilled it in the left center field for a base hit.
Well, it came back about three times faster than it came in, Joe. Robin Ventura, 0-2.
Well, we saw Hammond warming up in the bullpen. I think that might mean that, you know, line drive may have affected Roger. Mm-hmm. He may not come back out for the seventh inning.
If the Yankees can score for him, he could still win 299, even if that's the case. We'll see. The bullpen has been, not quite what the Yankee bullpen has been in the past. Wakefield, meanwhile, putting that committee in the Red Sox bullpen, all they've tabled that meeting. You know, they don't need a committee at this point.
Well, you can see Stottlemyre, Mel Stottlemyre, and Joe Torre talking. I'm sure it's about Roger and what they want to do pitching-wise. You know, of course, Mel's the pitching coach.
And there for a strike to Ventura. 3-1. Posada at first, 2-2 game, seventh inning. Here's Mariano Rivera, missed a lot of the inning. Jose Contreras made his debut. The much ballyhooed Contreras, who the Red Sox wanted to get, and the Yankees signed on Christmas Eve. He came in, got a double play, got three outs immediately in one inning, but surrendered five runs in the seventh and then lost it last night. Here's a walk to Ventura, and now two on, two out for Raul Mondesi, who was walked. Scored on Soriano's single that tied the game. And there, Mike Timlin, Mike Timlin up in the Red Sox pen.
And this is what I was talking about when you have a knuckleball pitcher, just stay close and you figure you'll have a chance. You get one base hit, he walks a guy. Now these first two pitches to Mondesi will be very important, because if he falls behind again and doesn't want to give in, then you can end up with the bases loaded. And anytime that happens, one little, you know, error or a little bloop someplace, and you're in trouble. So that's one of the problems that goes with being a knuckleball pitcher. I mean, you're always on the edge.
Nobody more on the edge than the catcher, Doug Mirabelli. I told you at the beginning of the game, uses what he calls a fast pitch softball catcher's mitt. Kind of like a first baseman's mitt. He can scoop a lot of things. That's not the huge pizza glove, but it is oversized.
That's what I'm talking about.
There it is in center field. Johnny Damon up with it, but forget it. The Yankees have themselves the lead as Posada's two-out single eventually allows him to come around and score.
Well, that's the one thing you try to do, a knuckleball pitcher. Just stay close to him, and you're going to have some opportunities, because if you get a base hit, he's going to help you out somewhere along the line. And with the walk, he helps him out. Here's that knuckleball. It's not dancing as much right there. Up a little bit, and good job by Mondesi to go back through the middle, not trying to pull it. And that's an experience factor right there. That shows you, you know, what the Yankees are all about. They're smart hitters, good smart hitting back through the middle. We saw Soriano do the same thing with two outs and a runner at second.
So Venturi is at third, Mondesi first, and here's Todd Zeal. And there goes the runner Mondesi, and that'll be uncontested as Mirabelli had to do his best to keep that ball from getting past him.
And again, that's what you have to do if you're the Yankees. Put pressure on him, you know, because you have a runner at third, puts pressure on Mirabelli back there just to catch the ball. So how is he going to catch it and still try to throw the runner out? So you just have to take advantage and force the issue when a knuckleball pitcher is pitching well and he gives you an opportunity to score.
So now, big picture, one run in. Maybe a little flare gets two more. But whether Clemens comes out or not, and we'll have to see because of that ball that hit back through the box. He's now got a great opportunity to pick up number 299. Two and one to count to Zeal, who played for Joe Torre 10 years ago when Todd was a catcher turned into third baseman when Joe Torre was the manager of the St. Louis Cardinals. For that one, and Wakefield has had a strikeout every inning. Would love to have one right now.
I've always felt the toughest pitch to hit off a knuckleball is a high dancing knuckleball because you're not staying on top of the ball as you normally would another guy's fastball.
Pops it. Nixon on. Makes the catch. Two stranded. But. The Yankees come up with a singleton as we head to the seventh inning stretch at Fenway. 3-2 New York.
Anytime I hear his voice, and when I was growing up, the weekends were spectacular because Kurt Gowdy's tones came across the TV, and it was just special.
Very knowledgeable. I think Kurt Gowdy knew everything about baseball, football, basketball, and fishing, because he fished a lot with Ted Williams.
Everybody most vividly remembers him, I think, nationally for the American Sportsman, where he'd take, you know, clumsy baseball players out and try to avoid having them drown while they fish.
This guy is one of the finest gentlemen that I've ever met in the game and was one of the greatest announcers in the game, Kurt Gowdy. I mean, that's the name that, unless you're 8 years old, everybody knows who Kurt Gowdy is.
Well, hey, you brought baseball, football, basketball. You brought sports, not to mention fishing, hunting. You brought it into our living rooms, whether it was on radio or on television, for us to enjoy. And I think we could hear in your voice, as we did tonight, Kurt, the enjoyment that you get just from games and the people who play them and are involved.
Well, you know, I was lucky in my career. I was always with a network that had the rights to things. You have to have a chance to do things.
Right.
And my favorite show of all time was doing the American Sports mm-hmm. for 20 years.
You made that fun for people that had never fished, never hunted. I know you were more fishing, but meanwhile, let's just say that Roger Clemens is out, and we'll get the official word on it in a moment, but he does stand to win number 299 at the Yankee bullpen, which will be Chris Hammond here in the eighth, the lefty, and obviously Mariano Rivera in the ninth. If they don't score here,
well, this is one of the places where a lot of people think the Yankees are weaker, trying to get to Mariano Rivera. Remember in the past they had Mike Stanton, who was a left-hander, could come in and shut down the left-handers. Well, that's Hammond's job now.
He's a different sort of pitcher,
and
too.
Definitely a different sort of pitcher. He's not a strikeout pitcher, and it's a whole different situation. So, again, this is where most people think the Yankees are vulnerable.
They got a right-hander warming up in the bullpen.
Rivera will be at the end, and first Hammond, and then it could be what we saw Contreras. So that's Antonio Osuna, who throws hard. And with Carce now out for the year, he's going to come perhaps a very big name, I think, this season. He may do well, and you may see him a lot late in the game for the Yankees. Meanwhile, Damon swings through that one for Hammond. Well, we should tell folks that you know, 3-2, I'll wait. You mentioned the American Sportsman, Kurt, but you grew up in Wyoming, so, I mean, the great outdoors was
You lived it in Cheyenne.
Yeah, that was our fun. Skiing and hunting and fishing, picnicking, hiking, climbing rocks. Hell, we didn't have any big cities to go to and all that entertainment. That was our.
We needed.
That was our. Yeah, that was all we knew.
I would ski with you. I wouldn't go fish with you, but I'd go skiing with you.
You might be a pretty good little fly fisher.
No, I'm a skier.
3-2 the count to Damon, and he chops that. Nice play, Jombi, and he'll beat the quick Damon.
Good job by Hammond to throw, come back from 3-0, and a good play by Giambi to get in front of that ball. He caught it on the in-between hop, and that's what you do not want to do, a tough hop there. See that ball there? I mean, that's a tough hop. But he's able to corral it, goes to first, one
we're
down.
Teammates there a couple years ago with Oakland, so Jason knew I better get going here when I get this ball. There's a park. The park named after you in your home state of Wyoming.
Yeah, right? Kurt Gowdy State Park. I'm very proud of it. Nicest thing that ever happened to me.
Is that right near Cheyenne? Or
halfway between Cheyenne and Laramie. It's 11,000 square acres. It's got two great lakes on it. And I go out there and see all the people fish there and hike and snowmobile and everything. And it makes me feel very, very good.
It's quite an honor.
Beautiful pitch there. That's what Hammonds does. He, you know, we talked about Stanton. He threw hard, had a good breaking ball and a changeup. Hammond throws a lot of off-speed pitches, and that was a good curveball to get strike two on Todd Walker.
Walker 3-for-3. Singled and was aboard when Garcia Pera homered in the first inning. Singled to lead off the third. Singled in the fifth. Stranded. Not a score in the first two games in this series.
He's hitting 322 now.
Yep. Well, I always knew that he could hit.
Walker.
The Twins, Reds. The question was his fielding. He's fielded better than a lot of folks thought. Little Fister, Jeter. Jombi makes the tag. A good defensive inning thus far for Jombi.
Two good plays in a row by him.
Well, let's go for some offense in the studio. Reese Davis, Rob Dibble. Fellas.
All right, Chris, Cardinals and Astros, Albert Pujols has been sizzling. This is his 13th home run, and while certainly Pujols has a potent bat, I'm not sure it's the most dangerous stick in the stadium. Watch the scramble for the souvenir, Rob.
A lot of rivalry in this division, especially between the fans.
Oh, look out. Good swing, and the aluminum bat conks the guy, but he still got the souvenir. 6-1 Astros, Cardinals.
Well, seen any of that here yet? All congregated as a thank you, fellas. With Garcia Pera coming up, bounced around a little bit, but he throws hard. But he's there. You see, with 16 strikeouts and 16 and a third, his walks are up for a relief pitcher. You need to get that down. He used to have better command of it, but he may figure very prominently in how the Yankees go this year out of the pen, Joe.
Well, I think Joe's trying to search for a pattern, you know, and maybe we just saw it. He brings Hammond in to try to get a couple of left-handers, as Stanton used to do, but Stanton was also effective against right-handers as well. Powering, he had 7 strikeouts in this ball game. He got Manny with a good splitter down and in. He gets Miller on a pitch away. Manny again, another splitter down. Millar, he just throws a fastball by him. Another fastball up and away, and he gets Millar again. But he was moving the ball around, and you could see not one of those strikeouts were in the strike zone. He would get 2 strikes, and he got him to chase pitches out of the strike zone.
Lost in the fact that he's about to win 300 games. He's now just 24 shy of 4,000 strikeouts with his 7 strikeouts tonight. How's that list, guys? No more Garcia Pera up against Antonio Osuna. 2-run homer first inning for Nomar. Hitting streak 22.
This guy's already won 2 batting titles. Red Sox, over the years, have won a lot of batting titles in the American League.
Jombi's been busy.
Yeah.
Very good defensive inning for Jambi and a good inning for the Yankee bullpen, who have protected the lead. We played 7-3 to a pinstriper.
Baseball brought to you by Johnsonville Brunt.
Chris Berman, Joe Morgan, Kurt Gowdy with you here at Fenway Park. And where else would we rather sit with Kurt Gowdy? That's for sure. In a game that Roger Clemens has a chance to win his 299th. The Yankees lead the Red Sox 3-2 here. And oh, never mind. I hear that lottery, and I think of Patrick Ewing, New York Knicks, whatever year that was. I'm not going to complete my thought. It's cleaner than it used to be. Let's just leave it at that, as Soriano will lead off the eighth inning. Soriano, Jeter, Jambi.
I remember the telecast of that, and the Yankees, when they picked Patrick Ewing, DeBuscher, the general manager,
yes,
Dave DeBuscher,
yep,
just died.
Yep.
And boy, he pounded the table and gave the victory sign, and it was a great draft pick for him.
Absolutely. That was, I don't want to get into it. The envelopes were hermetically sealed, they said. Meanwhile, a little flare by Soriano out to right field. Mixing up with it. And so the Yankees, who picked up that run in the seventh inning, now get the leadoff man out here on in the eighth with the heavy metal coming up against Mike Timlin, the new pitcher. And now the fun begins, because the Red Sox, much ballyhooed, bullpen by committee. Of course, this is different. They're behind, but their bullpen has been a, well, shall we say, Joe and Kurt, exciting.
Well, I personally like the idea sometimes of bullpen by committee. You just have to have the right committee out there, and I'm not sure they have that, because I think you can set up a rotation, you know, and use three or four pitchers out there and get the job done.
Jeter bunts a foul. Roger Clemens had 100 pitches tonight, though. He's been averaging 105. Of course, Roger has gone, you know, through his career, lots and lots more pitches than that in many outings, but he is 40 years old. And no word yet on whether there was an injury or whether it ticked the glove, or it may be just that he's thrown enough pitches. We don't.
No, he got hit.
Yeah, he somehow.
Somehow he got hit. It wasn't that it just ticked the glove.
Mm-hmm.
He got hit.
Well, they're not saying yet is that why he came out either one, but it doesn't matter. He's out of the game. The bullpen's trying to protect the 3-2 lead. And I mean, they just, well, when they come out, to put it in perspective, I mean, 300 wins, they'll be seeing it for one of the last times. But you can't get 300 until you get 299. Soriano has stolen a base tonight.
Now this is, you know, there's a lot of pressure on Timlin now. You know, he has to hold Soriano, and he has to make a good pitch to Jeter. And now if you're Joe Torre, you've got what you want, a perfect, you know, hit and run count. Because you tried to bunt, you fouled it off, now he misses. If you want to run, this is a good spot to do it in. Whether you let him steal the base or you try hit and run. And a good job by Timlin trying to keep him close at first base.
How many bases did he steal last year?
He had over 40 stolen bases. He was trying to be the first second baseman to hit 40 home runs and steal 40 bases.
40-40 man.
Yeah. And he came up one home run short.
That's quite an achievement.
Quite an achievement.
41 last year, Kurt, 43 the year before.
Well, they came up with a gem with him.
Oh, yeah. God, yes.
Very surprisingly.
Actually, he came from Japan. He had played over there, and the Yankees were able to sign him and bring him here.
Big brother is always watching.
Yeah.
Well, we're back. I said last one was a good count. This is an even better count, 2-1. I think you have to make something happen, because you don't want to sit there and wait and let Jeter hit a ground ball maybe into a double play.
There it goes.
And that's
there it is. And so Walker, look at Soriano's trying to go to third. Unbelievable. On a little hit and run, he goes from first to third.
Great base running.
Well, that's what they do. They make things happen, and they make Joe Torre's job easier when one of them gets on base. And you see Jeter kind of pointing at him, saying, good job by Soriano to get on there. 2-1, perfect hit and run count. They send the runner. Jeter chops it to the right side because I was surprised that Walker was covering. But now, Walker kind of takes his time a little bit and lobs it to first base. You have to realize that Soriano's running and fired to first base to give the first baseman a chance. You see Soriano just picks up the speed, and he's able to get there. So great, great hustle there by Soriano.
Well, that was a slow, high bounder, too, that gave him some space.
Yeah, but you got to fire the ball to first base when you have a base runner running right away, and Walker kind of lobbed it over there.
Kevin Brand will play that. Giambi gone. Soriano held. Two outs.
Good job by Timlin to get a sinker down, and Giambi kept it on the ground. And I like the fact that the Yankees didn't try to score on that particular play. Ball's hit too hard, first of all, but you also have Bernie Williams coming up behind him. Although I think that Bernie's knee is still bothering him because when he swings, he's getting jammed a little bit, and he's not able to use his legs as well as he normally does. But you still, if you're Joe Torre, you'll take your chances here.
Bernie Williams has struck out, flown out to center twice. Average now at 287. He got off to a very good April, which is uncharacteristic of Bernie. He usually is a slow starter. He's hit over 300 eight straight years.
Isn't he a musician?
Oh, yeah.
Cello?
Guitar. He probably plays, he could play that as well, but guitar both. A little rock and roll and kind of classical guitar. He enjoys that. He brings a guitar on the road. And so he relaxes a lot. Really quiet to himself.
I wish I'd have been good at music. I flunked the Christmas cantata in high school. I was the only guy they wouldn't put in the chorus. I couldn't carry a note.
You're out fishing. Yeah. In your park.
Not in December.
Look at Soriano now dance around. Timlin didn't even notice he was a third of the way down the line.
Well, you're not going to be able to steal home when the pitcher's in the stretch, so
right.
You don't have to worry about that.
No, he's just dancing. Brandon Lyon, the new closer, Rudy Cena, has just called up from Pawtucket in the bullpen. Two out. Crowd wants us out of here. There may have been empty seats before, Kurt and Joe, but there are none now.
Oh, no. Explain to the fans we had a drizzle all afternoon, and I suppose some of the fans are waiting and waiting to see what happened, and a little late coming in, but now the park is full, 35,000. Well, this Soriano is an exciting player.
Yes, he is.
I mean, he's something, I think.
Well, the one thing Joe Torre told me, Kurt, is that he has no fear. I mean, you know, he might strike out this time with the runner at third, but next time he thinks he'll get him in. I mean, he has no fear of failure. You know, he'll steal the base in a tough situation, and what he just did there, going from first to third, he's willing to take the chance.
Stand the line. Joe would certainly love another run.
Yeah, one run is a big deal in this situation because then you're almost assured that you'll get to Rivera with a lead, you know, even if you give up the run the bottom of the inning. But
got him. Timlin settles in, strands Soriano as we head to the bottom of the eighth here at Fenway, 3-2 Yanks. Easily lead the Red Sox 3-2, the largest three-game series crowd at Fenway since 1990. 35,000 plus all three games. And the Red Sox trailing by a run here in the eighth against Antonio Osuna have Manny Ramirez, Kevin Millar, and Trot Nixon, 4-5-6.
I think Bucky Harris used to have the greatest term for this ballpark, hold your breath. Well, I used to say you could have a five-run lead here and blow it with that wall out there. It's a hold-your-breath ballpark. You never have enough runs in the lead.
First game I ever came to at Fenway, Kurt, Sonny Siebert was pitching for the Red Sox.
Yeah.
Had a no-hitter through six innings. lost 11-8.
Well, I've seen some great comebacks here in the eighth, ninth innings. A couple of walks, a base hit, and boom, over the wall.
Well,
four runs in.
Think the plot's any good tonight? First place at stake. Clemens, the former Red Sox, with a chance to win .299. Boston trying to battle from behind. Bucky Dent sitting up in those new seats on the Green Monster. Kurt Gowdy in the booth. Joe Morgan in the booth. I don't know. I think it's, oh, what a play by Ventura. The long throw, and he got it.
Boy, now that's how you win gold gloves. He knew he didn't have the arm strength to throw it all the way, so he threw a one hopper. He got rid of it quickly. Now watch this. He'll catch the ball running away. Knows he can't stop. He just gets rid of it. See how quickly he gets rid of the ball? One hopper at first, and he's out.
Marvelous nice play.
I mean, that's the tough part right there. That was a tough hop to catch, and then he just gets rid of it because you don't have that type of arm strength when you're running that far away from first base to throw it in the air. So good play there by Robin Ventura.
Defensive play of the night. One out in the Red Sox eight, and Kevin Millar is up. Walked and struck out twice. So Antonio Osuna came on with two outs in the seventh. After Chris Hammond, the lefty, got the first two outs of the seventh. And warming in the Yankee pen is you know who. Teams will play again at Yankee Stadium Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and if it stays this way, that's you know who right there. He's been pretty automatic. Mariano Rivera. Well, that's certainly an area that's changed big time, Kurt, since you in your heyday calling play-by-play.
Yeah.
Although they had the guy, the monster, Dick Raddatz, who was pretty impressive here for a couple of years, right?
I nicknamed him the monster.
You did?
And he got mad at me for it. But he come out of that bullpen, it looked like Frankenstein coming in. Oh, he was huge, and he'd waddle in, and he could throw.
So wait a minute, you're doing nicknames before I was?
A little bit.
A little bit.
Ventura again. My last inning was Jombie's inning. This is Ventura's this far. Millar gone.
You know, did you play in the 70 World Series?
No. 70
against Baltimore?
No, I wasn't there in Cincinnati then.
Brooks Robinson was a third.
Yeah.
I want to tell you, he must have made 8 or 9 unbelievable plays.
Well, he won the most valuable player in the World Series because of his glove. Not so much his hitting. He hit well also, but
benching those guys kept hitting the ball down to third. He was in foul territory. He was on his knees. He was diving to his left. I never saw a guy make so many great plays.
Trent Nixon, 1-for-3, singled in the fourth. Certainly was nobody that ever fielded better at that position than Brooks.
Now, wait a minute, see?
Okay, see, that's why I'm leading you on.
That's me and you. I was in a tavern one night in Palm Beach, Florida, and a bunch of guys from Philadelphia were there.
Right.
Including Tim McCarver. They were down there for a golf tour. And we got arguing. They said, I tell you, the guy was a better glove man at third than Brooks was Mike Schmidt. I never saw Mike Schmidt play.
Well, Mike was a great defensive third baseman. He had more physical ability. He had a real strong arm, and he was a great athlete. But I don't know if you can ever play third base better than Brooks Robinson.
I don't know how you can.
Yeah, but, I mean, Mike was definitely a great third baseman. He won a lot of gold gloves as well.
Well, I had over 500 homers.
Just
productive. As
funny little story with Brooks.
I know where you're going. Let's see if Trout will give us a couple of pitches.
Come on, Trout.
Yeah, he'll give us another bat here. Base on balls, Hillenbrand.
Anyway, I was doing a bird hunting show in Maine on the American Sportsman with Brooks 10 years after the Mets upset them in the '69 World Series. We had an early dinner. We went up there. I had a suite up there, and he was pacing up and down the floor. I said, what's the matter? What are you so nervous about? He said, I don't know how we ever lost to the Mets. 10 years yeah. later, he's still agonizing over that World Series
loss. I can tell you how they lost. Very crucial.
Yeah.
Well, I have to tell you, I have the same feeling about the 72 series with the A's. I still think we should have won, but obviously.
I don't.
Yeah, I told Sparky,
I did your closing National League playoffs.
Right.
And that was in Cincinnati.
Right.
Playing Pittsburgh, right. So they told me to stay over. The World Series would start there.
Well.
Well, I'll finish this story.
Wheels are turning. Damian Jackson to pinch run for Nixon. Oh, we're going to get the more than one inning save attempt for Rivera. Figure of Mariano Rivera out of the pen with two out here in the eighth inning and a runner on to try to nail down this win, which would be number 299 lifetime for Roger Clemens. Mariano hurt a lot earlier this year. This will be his eighth game, but you can see those sort of numbers are what the Yankees have grown to expect with an ERA of just over one.
Seven innings pitched, only four hits he's allowed.
Well, the Red Sox have countered by bringing in Damian Jackson to run, and he's stolen eight bases in 10 attempts, so we'll see what happens here.
The view from on top of the watchtower.
And one thing about Rivera, he does give you time to run.
Shea Hillenbrand digging in.
And
Jackson, no, dancing.
Yeah, they got
and he's out. Oh, my goodness. You talk about egg on your face. How about that? Rivera gets out of the inning with no pitches. Oh, man.
Pretty good relief.
Shades of the A's, right? Pinch runner Washington. Big picture, first place at stake. Roger Clemens. Three outs away from win number 299. It'll be in the hands of Mariano Rivera. And now out of the pen, someone just called up from Pawtucket. Rudy Cienes. Been around, Braves, et cetera. And Grady Little said that a long time ago when he was managing in the low minors, he saw Cienes pitch a no-hitter. And he says, always in the back of my head that I've always liked this stuff. And Red Sox, one of those guys they signed, and Pawtucket, and here he is, and he'll pitch the ninth. Matsui Posada Ventura. By the way, Damian Jackson in right field. That's the last place he wants to be. Where they can see him after getting picked off. Mirabelli grabs it. Matsui gone. One out of the Yankee ninth. With two out. Breaking a streak of 13 straight guys retired by Tim Wakefield. He eventually came around to score in a single by Mondesi in the seventh, and that's how we stand. We had thunder in the first inning. If you're tuning in late, Jason Giambi had a solo homer his ninth. Nomar Garcia-Pera had a two-run homer the ninth in the bottom of the first inning. And there it is, Clemens out. What a lineup card that he might enjoy one day, because he's three outs away from number 299. Trying to become the 21st man ever to win 300 games.
Bill Cronin used to tell me about Lefty Grove. You know, he wound up here with the Red Sox and trying to get his 300th win. It took about a month there, and he had real problems. And finally, I think he won a 10-9 game or 12-11, but he finally got his 300th win.
It was the same for Early Win. They both ended with 300 wins.
Yeah.
It took him a long time, too, I remember.
Early Win took the longest time to pitch of any pitcher I ever saw. He'd stroll out to the dugout to the mound, and he'd stare in, he'd step back. I used to say, can't you speed things up? He said, where are you going? You got no place to go.
Well, then what you're saying is, Kurt, he was late Win, not early Win.
Yeah, he was awful late. He was a great pitcher.
Absolutely. Well, I think you're on that list at 300.
He had an easy delivery.
This is El Teante.
Never had a sore arm.
How about that fella? Louis Tiant. Boy, they loved him here.
Louis.
The best.
They'd scream.
The best. Posada walks. Well, this is what Roger Clemens is trying to go after. All right, I mean, here it is. As Mirabelli and Cienes talk, that here it is. I don't think anyone's going to catch Cy Young with 5'11". Can we count on him and say that?
There you are.
Or Walter Johnson with 4'17", and then Matheson and Alexander. There's Warren Spahn. All these guys are a long time ago, and there's Spahn with 363.
Yeah. He's a modern, yeah. Kid Nichols rolls.
The next man. Three guys are before the gay 90s. Carlton, 329. Clarkson, gay 90s. That's the first half of the list.
Well, one of the reasons you're not going to see guys get 300 wins is because they pitch every fifth day now. And in the old days, they pitch every fourth day and even sometimes every third day. So you're not going to get as many starts, or therefore you're not going to get as many chances.
If they did it in the old days, why don't they do it nowadays? Why do they have to pitch every fifth day?
Well, that's been something I asked a couple of general managers over the years, and they said they get spoiled in the minor leagues because they're trying to protect their arms in the minor leagues. And they get spoiled to the point where when they get to the big leagues, they're expecting to pitch every fifth day. So it's something that started occurring in the minor leagues, and they carried it right on through to the big leagues.
Going nowhere. And then here's the second half of that very famous list. Now, guys that we saw pitch: Don Sutton, Nolan Ryan, Phil Niekro, Gaylord Perry, Tom Seaver. And then a couple of old timers, three of them, and then the two we mentioned, Grove and Wynn. But that's it. That's a pretty exclusive club right there.
What about Haas?
Haas Radburn.
Haas Radburn.
A favorite of your son, Kurt Gowdy Jr., my producer for
Haas Radburn.
Haas Radburn. He'd love Haas Radburn.
Sounds like he's from Wyoming, Haas.
That's right. He is now. We just said so. But there's Sutton and Niekro, and of course, Nolan Ryan was the last to get to 300 in 1990, a guy that's been the idol, really, of Roger Clemens, Nolan Ryan. 2-2 to Ventura. Count full now. Mondesi on deck. Posada. We assume Ventura gets the bat on the ball and send him here, Joe?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, Ventura does strike out a lot, and Posada doesn't run that well, but, you know, since you're ahead, you might want to go ahead and put him in motion.
He's doing it, and oh, Ventura delivers. Pass to diving Miller. Here comes Posada with Ramirez digging the ball out, and he's going to be waved home by Willie Randolph. The relay from Garcia Parra, safe.
Posada just kind of ran and stepped on home plate. He didn't slide. I guess he's okay. He seems to be okay. But that's why you put a knee. Once he rounds second, you can see Willie Randolph hustling him home. And a good job of base running by Posada. I mean, never slowed down. And he was trying to block the throw from the outfield is one of the reasons he didn't slide. But I think he can really get hurt going in the home plate like that. But he scores the run.
You gonna give me kudos for managing on that, Joe? That's what we wanted to do, runner in motion. And how about Ventura here in the late innings? The two big plays at third base, and now a huge insurance run for Roger Clemens. 298 has a heck of a chance to become number 299 for the Rocket Man. 40-year-old Texan, although he's born in Dayton, Ohio. He's excelled at Texas, College World Series, nailed that down, and then came here to Boston in 1984, won his first Cy Young in 1986, and 87, 91. Two more in Toronto when it's 97 and 98. One more with the Yankees in 2001. And he's going to get to about 300 wins and 4,000 strikeouts at about the same time.
Well, he allowed 9 hits, but not much damage.
After the homer. So here's Mondesi. And if this stays up, is that you, Joe, Monday?
No, I'm Wednesdays.
Memorial Day Monday, Yankee Stadium against the Red Sox. Against the Red Sox would be, if this lead holds up, the Rocket Man's attempt at baseball immortality. At the
He hasn't somewhat reached it already. Steve O'Brien with Sutcliffe on that one. Mondesi gone. Zeal up. And if you're looking ahead to the Boston ninth, remember Hillenbrand was up when Jackson got picked off, so he'll lead off. Hillenbrand, Miller, and Mirabelli, 7-8-9.
Well, I'd rather go into the ninth with a two-run lead instead of a one-run lead.
Makes a big difference. One swing, you're always one swing away with a one-run lead, but you have to get someone on to be able to tie it. It technically gives the relief pitcher a big margin for error because he can go after the first hitter, you know, until he gets someone on base. He can just go right after them. Well, Rivera's going to do that anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
And another count to Todd Zeal. It's the rubber game of this three-game series. Yankees won Monday 7-3, Boston yesterday 10-7. The Yankees hold on. They'll be back in first place by one game over the Red Sox.
Zeal has just thrown the ball very well. He's just missing his spot. He's throwing well.
Red Sox have tomorrow off. They host Cleveland over the weekend before going to New York for that three-game series. Yankees have four with Toronto beginning tomorrow night at Yankee Stadium.
Toronto sort of come back.
Yeah. Cinez.
Yeah, one dangerous hitter there, Delgado.
Yep. Very dangerous.
I saw him in the Florida State League. Class A League. He tore it up. I knew he was going to be a major leaguer.
Kind of on their feet. Want to end this thing with just a one-run night. Cinez does it. Ventura, though, a big blow. The double has given the Yankees a two-run lead heading to the bottom of the ninth.
A global premiere event. It was the largest nation in the world, run by lunatics, a genius, and a harlot. The czars ruled over a people for 900 years of torture, murder, and war. Ivan, Peter, Catherine, and Nicholas. This Memorial Day, feel what life was like under the most treacherous rulers in the world. Russia, land of the czars, begins Monday on the...
Reese Davis, Rob Dibble with you, Phillies and Mets. Dan Plesac on for the 1,023rd time. It's in fifth on the all-time list.
That's no way to treat your elders.
Cliff Floyd taking him out, ninth home run. We're tied at four in the bottom of the eighth. Barry Bonds sitting on 625 and sitting in the dugout waiting for the Giants to take on the Diamondbacks in a few moments.
All right, fellas. Hey, he's 35 away from Willie Mays. Unbelievable. Barry Bonds with 625. Speaking of milestones, the Yankees four, the Red Sox two in the bottom of the ninth. Chris Berman, Joe Morgan, and Kurt Gowdy here on the beginning of our Living Legends series on some selected Wednesdays. And with Mariano Rivera on the hill with a two-run lead, it gives Roger Clemens a chance to get to 299 wins if the Yankees can nail this down. And with history perhaps in the making a little bit, who am I to call it? I turn it over to a man that's called more big moments than the rest of us can dream about. Kurt Gowdy, take it away.
Thank you. Very gracious, Chris. Shea Hillenbrand looks at a strike. Hillenbrand is grounded to short. Grounded out and single. One out of three. The Red Sox have had nine hits, but could only come up with two runs. One of them was a home run by Garcia Pera in the first inning. The one strike pitch inside, a ball and a strike. On deck is Millar.
Billy Miller.
Miller.
And then probably a pinch hitter for Mirabelli, I would assume. That's Jeremy Giambi we may see.
Fly ball, deep right center, backward, Williams back. He tracks it down, and he's got it. No, he drops the ball. He drops the ball on the edge of the warning track. He tracked it down, got to it, and dropped it.
Fastball that stayed in the plate is supposed to be a cutter away, but it's a high fly ball. And you see that Bernie calls off Mondesi and then just drops it.
Wow.
He called Mondesi off and dropped the ball.
So two base error on Williams, Kurt, and that brings Bill Miller up.
Well, now that extra base, that extra run really means a lot.
Miller's had two hits and three times up. Yankees ahead 4-2, last of the ninth inning. Too close to Miller. One ball, no strikes. More bellies due on deck.
Well, they're going to have Jeremy Giambi pinch hit for him.
Fouled away. One ball, one strike. There he is on deck. Jason's brother. Jeremy Giambi, a brother in each dugout. One ball, one strike. Runner on second, nobody out. Rivera's delivery. Check swing strike. Well, that was a tough pitch.
Well, that's what he does. He starts the fastball toward the middle of the plate, then it runs in, and you can see Bill Miller trying to stop his swing, but definitely took a swing at it. I think sometimes he is as tough on left-hand hitters as he is right-handed hitters.
One ball, two strikes. Runner on second, nobody out. A looper. Foul. Just fouled on the third baseline.
That's what he does. He inside out. A lot of doubles for Miller.
Well, Miller's able to fight the ball off inside. That's that same cut fastball in, and he just kind of inside out this pitch, and he fights it off.
And it goes foul.
Ball count, 1-2. Nobody out, runner on second, last of the ninth, 4-2 Yankees. And that is hit to short. Runner holds at second. The thrower, he's out. Jeter throws him out, and a runner still at second base. Doug Mirabelli is due up, but Giambi will come up to pitch hit. Jeremy Giambi. Speaking of brothers, one of the famous brother teams of all time were the Dean brothers. Paul and Dizzy were the Cardinals. And one day, Dizzy, I think it was against the Dodgers, pitched a two-hit shutout in the opening game. And then Paul pitched a no-hitter in the second game. And Dizzy went in and threw his glove against the wall and said, "My brother should have told me that, or I'd have pitched a no-hitter, too." Fly ball out of play. He was that way, old Diz. World Series, Joe. He was in a rundown play against the Tigers, and in the rundown, he got hit in the head with a throwing ball. They took him to the hospital and x-rayed him, and the next day, the paper said, "X-ray of Dizzy's brain shows nothing." A looper in the left center coming hard.
Nice play.
A great play by Matsui, the left fielder. The Japanese rookie in the Major Leagues of America makes a running great play. Boy, that was an important play.
Very important.
And that drops those runners on first and third.
Well, we said earlier that he had played left field better than they anticipated. He doesn't have a strong arm, but he runs well. He gets a good jump on the ball. And he makes a nice catch. And Giambi thought it might drop in, but very nice catch there by Matsui.
Johnny Damon is the last man up, the last hope for the Red Sox in the last of the ninth inning. Takes a strike on the inside corner. Yankees leading 4-2. Red Sox are down to their last out. A great game. Marvelous pitching by Dick Wakefield and Roger Clemens. Ground ball is short. This could end it. Up with Jeter. The throw. The ball game's over. And the Yankees have captured the rubber game of the three-game series and go one game up on the Red Sox in their division here. Clemens gets the record of 299, and the next time he goes out, he's going after 300. Hey, it's been a pleasure, Chris and Joe. I love you both.
Hey, it's been my pleasure.
It's been an honor.
Yeah,
it's been more than a pleasure, Kurt. It's been an honor.
You know, I remember Joe, the little rat. He got the winning hit against our Red Sox in that fabulous World Series of 1975. Little looper out in the center.
Well, it depends on where you were. If you were in Cincinnati, it was a line drive. If you were in Boston, it was a looper.
I'm going to drop in that dirty rat.
Well, listen, you returning to Fenway is a gift to all of us. And you honored us with your presence here. And I hope that the fans at home, Joe, got as much out of it as you and I did today.
I'm sure they did. And this is a great way to kick off the Living Legend series with Kurt Gowdy. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Have a great summer, Kurt. Come visit us again, will you, please?
Invite me.
You're here. Well, the final here as Roger Clemens picks up win number 299. As he does it in Fenway Park in Boston. The Yankees win it 4-2. We have a couple games coming, the Giants and Diamondbacks, so the Rockies and Dodgers coming up. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Joe Morgan and one of the greatest ever, Kurt Gowdy, I'm Chris Berman. Thanks for watching here in Boston. The final again, 4-2 Yanks, the Rocket Man with 299.